Good morning, everyone. Welcome. I'm Bob Zimmer. I'm president of the University of Chicago, and it's a great pleasure to see all of you here this morning. As you know, this year is the 125th anniversary of the founding of the University of Chicago. We have a sequence of events that have taken place on campus throughout the fall, and every anniversary like this gives you an opportunity to both reflect backwards and to look forward, and of course the past and the present are indeed closely related. So today we're focused on a very particular item, and that item is the relationship of the University of Chicago to a set of important laboratories, two of them Department of Energy laboratories, one being the Marine Biological Laboratory. And the university is actually quite unusual, not only in the extraordinary accomplishments of its science over the years, but in the context of having these laboratories that are affiliated and that have been part of the university's history in science for many years. It's quite interesting to look at these laboratories, because you might think that the Marine Biological Laboratory is the latest one to join the University of Chicago enterprise, but you could actually make an argument that it was the first one, because the very first director, Charles Whitman of the Marine Biological Laboratory, was a University of Chicago faculty member, and in fact, MBL was led for its first 40 years by University of Chicago faculty members. So that relationship, while looking new, is actually very old and deep. Now, the two DOE labs, of course, grew out of the work at the University of Chicago during World War II, and with the deep commitment of the federal government to science that followed World War II, Argonne, as many of you know, was founded, in fact, as a direct outgrowth of the Manhattan Project to focus on peaceful uses of nuclear energy. And the Fermilab, of course, became the, and remains, the center point for high energy physics in the United States. You're going to hear a lot about, again, the past, present, and future of these laboratories, of their relationship to the university. I might just offer a couple of comments about laboratories and the importance of the connection of universities to laboratories in general and why we view this as so important. These three laboratories in particular, but many other DOE labs, other independent labs, are not just other versions of universities. They do different things, they have different capacities, each one being itself slightly different. Argonne, of course, has enormous capacity across a vast array of enterprises. However, what Argonne and, in fact, the DOE labs can do as general is be much more focused on project than large-scale projects than the university is able to do by itself. That's the case both at Argonne and at Fermilab, and if you look at the Marine Biological Laboratory, that has been for its whole history the single greatest convener of biologists for research and education in the country. So you see each of them doing things that are different than a university would do. And the strength here, and in some sense the challenge and the art form of all of this, is how you have a university and laboratories which are different and have different capacities and different strengths, and how you put them together so that they can do things together that neither of them can do alone. One of the exciting things about science, of course, is that you're always at a critical moment. You are always pushing the edge. You are always at the technological edge, the funding edge, the conceptual edge. And that means that science at universities and laboratories are always at a critical moment. And indeed, these laboratories are each in their own way at a critical moment, which is a healthy thing. Fermilab, which has been, as I said, the center of high energy physics in the United States for a long time, with the closing of the Tevatron, which had been the workhorse of this field for a few decades, is now turning its attention to neutrinos and working on building the Long Base 9 Line neutrino facility and the Deep Underground neutrino experiment, both in here and in South Dakota, which will be the frontier of neutrino research. Argonne, which has one of the world's great machines in the advanced photon source, needs to upgrade that machine. You can think about the advanced photon source as a gigantic X-ray machine that lets you see at an atomic and molecular level instead of just your bones. And that machine needs to be upgraded so you can, for example, see things in actually evolving over time. And the Marine Biological Laboratory, which has been focused to some extent and certainly most well known for its summer activities, is now thinking about how to expand that extraordinary convening power that it has in the summer to a full year. So these are exciting moments for each of these laboratories. The one other thing I would say about them is each one of them is at the technical edge. These are examples of extreme technology, technology that you can't find any other place. This has important implications for science, just as technology and science have been wound up together since, for a millennia. And it's also important when one thinks about the connectivity to the city of Chicago, to developing technology, creating an innovation ecosystem, developing jobs, and so on. An example of this, of course, is the work of the university together with Argonne in forming the Institute for Molecular Engineering, its connectivity to the university and innovation being realized through the Chicago Innovation Exchange on 53rd Street. So this is, as I say, it's an exciting moment for the laboratories, an exciting moment for the development of science, engineering, and technology at the university, and I'm glad you're here today to hear from leaders past and present of these laboratories. Now, it's a great pleasure for me to welcome and introduce our mayor. It is not always the case that someone in my position, a university of our standing inside a city, can count on a mayor to understand what we're doing, what our goals are, how we can contribute to the city, how we can work in partnership. From the first week that the mayor was in office, he demonstrated and has continued to demonstrate his deep commitment to the evolution of science, of technology, of innovation, and everything that it can bring to the city and everything that the university can both help in and benefit from. So the mayor is here this morning. We just couldn't be more pleased that he's here. And he can't stay for long, but he is going to say a few words to us. So please welcome Rahm Emanuel.
First of all, Bob, thank you very much for the introduction. As I said to Bob earlier, I apologize for the way I'm dressed, but I have other things I'm doing today. But given that it was scientists, I thought I was appropriately dressed, and then who knew? Second, given all the sound around, I said I felt so at home here at City Council. So don't worry. That's the beauty of being at a university campus. Let me, first of all, to everybody that's part of the University of Chicago family, the city of Chicago is a richer, more intellectually vibrant city because of the University of Chicago. And if you think today where 40 years ago, people were leaving cities, and then you think of today, across the globe, there is a renaissance of urban centers, and there's about 100 cities across the globe that run and drive the intellectual, cultural, and economic energy of the world. City of Chicago is one of those cities. Not just me claiming it, you can look at any international study about it. And the reason for that, or the primary reason, is because of the universities we have here in the city. 35% of the people in the city of Chicago have a four-year college degree. In the United States, it's 27%. We have more academic institutions than any other city in America, except for Boston. The reason we're the number one city for corporate relocations and corporate expansions is because of our university systems. And every time I go on a recruiting trip to ask a company to move or expand in the city of Chicago, they ask me how many Fortune 500 companies I have in the city. And the truth is, Chicago fights above its weight class. But I said, what you should really be asking is about our universities. 15 institutions within the city limits itself, not counting the two national labs that border the city. And I know that we're going to be talking about, and you guys will, as noted by Bob, about all the research centers and that are going on from Argonne, Fermi, the Marine. But I also think of the city, University of Chicago, and its contribution from the School of Social Thought, its Department of Economics, its policies as it relates to education policy, urban specifically, as well as its crime lab. At so much of the things that we are doing as a city to continue to be a driver in the 21st century, both intellectual, cultural, and economic driver, the city of Chicago benefits from the University of Chicago and its research capacity, its intellectual curiosity, and its capacity to always look at the frontier and ask why. On a simple note, I know you're going to be talking about, obviously, science and technology. Today, the city of Chicago calls itself home as the number one city for and the largest international baccalaureate program, IB program, inside a public school system. The origination of that idea came from a study the city of Chicago's U of C's School on Urban Education showed that our IB schools, or schools with IB programs, did better at getting kids both to high school graduation, to college, and to Ivy League schools, and by 40 or 50% for kids of color. It was from that we decided to make 7 schools all IB and expand from 13 schools to 19 schools IB programs and now have the largest IB program, both high school and elementary schools. So at every level, the University of Chicago continues to be an intellectual, economic, and cultural resource that the city draws on. And so while you celebrate 125 years, I think it's appropriate, as the president noted, to not only look in the past, but to use it as a source of energy, enthusiasm to project the next 125 years. I'm confident in the strength of this city because we have institutions like the University of Chicago continue to push the frontier in every aspect. And so while today is a discussion about the past, the present, and the future, I would hope you to continue that curiosity, that intellectual energy, because the city immensely benefits from the depth of what goes on in these institutions here to continue to be a world-class city with world-class capacity. Thank you.
Now to lead the rest of the program, it's my pleasure to introduce Eric Isaacs, known to one and all. Eric, of course, was the former director of Argonne National Laboratory and now the provost of the University of Chicago. Eric.
Thanks, Bob. And I would like to add my welcome. It's very interesting to follow both your boss, president of the university, and the mayor of Chicago, but I will try. As Bob's already said, the University of Chicago is really unique in many ways, having two national DOE labs as well as the Marine Biological Lab as partners is tremendously impactful, not just for the labs, but also for the university. I mean, these labs, as has already been mentioned, pursue really aggressively big, ambitious ideas. And they can do that in some ways uniquely because they're focused and they're also they're enabled by a mission to work with scientists and engineers to really pursue the big things. And they do this in many ways, as Bob's mentioned, by building major facilities like the Advanced Photon Source. We're going to hear a little bit about a future source to study neutrinos, the Large Baseline Neutrino Facility. These are the kinds of things that only can be done at these major labs. We'll hear also about Marine Resources Facility at the Marine Biological Lab, where scientists can come together and solve major problems. But one thing I want to emphasize about these labs is they're tremendous in convening different types of groups that you would not see happen anywhere else. Not only do they convene scientists and engineers, faculty and staff and scientists at these institutions, but they're able to bring together people from the region in innovation, people from industry, and people from universities. And you can't underestimate the value of these laboratories as, if you will, a level playing field to bring together universities in the Chicago region, for example, University of Chicago and Northwestern, to solve major problems. And one of the examples here is one that you might hear a little about today, too. In addition to these big machines, these labs mount major programs in science, one of them being in battery research. And you'll hear a little bit about our Energy Innovation Hub, which does battery work. That innovation hub is 14 partners, a third of whom are universities, University of Chicago, Northwestern, University of Illinois. That's a unique capacity for laboratories to be able to bring together a talent which normally wouldn't interact and often leads to exciting and new things. So it's these laboratories that have been uniquely associated with University of Chicago, have been uniquely forceful in the way they brought together the faculty and scientists, and have really built out in really exciting and interesting ways for science and for innovation and engineering. So it's really my pleasure today to be able to run these couple of panels. But first, I wanted to introduce somebody who's been long affiliated with the University of Chicago. It is really my pleasure to introduce Walter Massey. He's currently the president of the School of the Art Institute at Chicago, but I'd like to say a few other things about him before he comes up. He has a remarkable career, unique, I think, in the world, if not in the city of Chicago. Walter has been president emeritus of Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia. He's emeritus trustee of the University of Chicago. He serves on the boards of Argonne and the Marine Biological Lab. He was director of Argonne National Labs in the late 70s and early 80s, and we'll hear a bit about that in a few minutes. He was professor of physics and vice president of research here at the university, and at the same time, he was also director of Argonne. He's been director of the National Science Foundation. He was provost and senior vice president of the 10-campus University of California system, and importantly there, of course, the University of California is the only other university that manages as many labs as we do. They manage 3 labs, so that was a deep connection Walter had out there. He's been director and chairman of the board at Bank of America. So suffice it to say, throughout his career, he has shown unparalleled commitment to science and technology, unparalleled commitment to diversity in education, and now as a president of the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, really committed to culture and the arts. And so with that, I'd like to welcome Walter up onto the stage. So, welcome, Walter.
Thanks, Eric.
So I'd like to start with a question related to your vast experience. As vice president for research here at the university, you had a deep connection to Argonne, also director of Argonne, and as the provost and VP at the University of California, also ran 3 DOE labs. So maybe you can start by describing a little bit of the value of that relationship between national labs, Department of Energy labs, and universities, and why that's special compared to, say, some of the other 15 or 14 national labs.
Well, you may not know, as you will recall, that one of the original ideas for GOCOs, government-owned contractor-operated laboratories, a system by which universities and other entities now operate these labs, was to have entities and national labs that to be able to attract scientists who did not want to work directly for the government, and also to provide an atmosphere where the scientists and engineers at the laboratories would enjoy the same intellectual and academic freedom that they had at universities. And this was particularly true at Los Alamos, which was the University of California, and it was in New Mexico. How are you going to attract people there to work on this project? So the idea of having a culture of intellectual freedom and academic inquiry that the universities can bring to the labs were very important in the beginning, and I think that's still true. Also, universities and the ones that run these labs, California and this one, are entities that are really committed to standards of excellence and quality in everything they do. So those standards carry over to the laboratories that they operate. An operator is probably not the defining word. The institutions that they manage in the sense of the government contract, but institutions with which they have partnerships. So I think that that in itself is a great value. Also, as it evolved over the years, of course, the value has become a more granular in terms of allowing for scientific interactions across the boundaries of the two institutions.
Is it, so when you were the director of Argonne, can you say a few things about how, specifically how the university faculty work closely with Argonne itself to drive new ideas and how that worked?
Well, I could, but I couldn't say much. Actually, what I've been pleased to see over the last, it's been 30 years, is how those interactions have grown. You recall the history of the lab here is we were mostly a nuclear lab even when I came.
Yeah.
We had a major synchrotron program for users, and the university had no engineering program. And so the opportunities for really deep overlaps were not as strong as they are now. I think another value that universities' management of the labs bring, and that was more valuable as when I was director, is universities provide a buffer or a barrier between the government, and I'm not anti-government, between the government and the institutions, sort of protected from the vicissitudes and sometimes political atmospheres produce. When I was director, there was a threat. I don't know how serious it was. We took it seriously. The Tribune did. It was a headline that the Argonne might be closed during the early Reagan administration because of budget cutbacks. The university, through its influence in Congress and throughout the state, managed to make sure that Argonne came through that period sound. And they instituted a form of governance, which I also think is very important, Eric, because it allows the University of Chicago, even though they manage the labs, to bring in individuals from the outside. They instituted these boards of governors. So now each lab has a board of directors or a board of governors, which allows the Bob's chairs, all of them, but they have individuals from industry, from other universities, and the like. And the laboratories really value that and I think benefit from that. The scientific interactions have accelerated considerably over these last 30 years, and now I'm pleased to see that the boundaries are very permeable.
So you mentioned that the lab was nearly closed when you came in as lab director.
Well, threatened to be closed.
So what would you say were your, in addition to that one, which is a fairly serious challenge, when you stepped up as director of the lab, what were the major initiatives or strategic initiatives you put forth, and what were the challenges to make those happen?
The major challenge when I came in was when my appointment was announced, I think it was about 10 days later, Three Mile Island happened. And if anyone remembers, it was almost a meltdown, they called it a nuclear plant out east in Pennsylvania. And Argonne being the leading laboratory in the area of nuclear safety, we got very much involved. But that started prompting the debate nationally about the safety and effectiveness and viability of nuclear energy in the United States. And so we found ourselves having to defend that program. And so one of our first initiatives was to reinvigorate and re-energize and refocus our nuclear research around something that was called the liquid metal breeder reactor, which is still going on. We had a lab out west, as you know, then Argonne West. The other, we had just, the lab was called diffuse because we were accused of having research across too many areas. We had a major review from DOE during that period, and I just wrote it down last night, said the atmosphere at the lab is more academic than industrial. And Peter, you may still need to defend that. I don't know. But I think the criticism in some ways were valid. That we didn't have we had too many small programs. We didn't have a major facility, user facility. And we didn't have programs that seemed to focus directly on working with industry. So we invigorated the nuclear program. So that was a big mission-driven program. We upgraded a neutron source called the Intense Pulse Neutron Source for Material Studies, and we began to work on the APS, the Advanced Photon Source. And we tried to focus the research of, and the basic research in support of those programs. So that's when we created a material science division mm-hmm. whose emphasis was on materials that might support the nuclear programs and the APS. Mm-hmm. Those were the big, we had to lay off about 500 people with the Reagan cutbacks when they cut out environmental research and the like. But the lab has come through very much strong. And during that period, Hannah Gray was president here. The university was very, very critical mm-hmm. in helping us to mobilize support throughout the Chicago region and the Illinois delegation in protecting the lab and getting the resources to grow.
You know, throughout the years, the labs, as you sort of intimated, academic versus more applied or industrial focused, have been asked to do more or less of the innovation in the country, right? The large national investment in the labs, a lot of science, a lot of engineering, and have been asked more or less to do innovation. When you came to the lab, what was the state of the interaction with the scientists and innovation, and how did you think about energizing that core of focus, if you will, at the Institute at Argonne?
Well, it was an important period. Those of you who've been in this a long time will know prior to 1980, it was almost impossible for laboratories and universities to really spin off research from federally funded, research that was funded by the federal government until they passed something called the Bayh-Dole Act in 1980, Senator Bayh and Senator Dole, which allowed universities and laboratories to be able to claim exclusive rights to the research if they were committed to trying to patent it or spin it off. And we tried to take advantage of that. And again, here's the university was very key in working with the lab, and we formed something called the Argonne National Laboratory University of Chicago Development Corporation, ARCH for short. And the university actually put up about $5 million out of its endowment to create a venture fund, the ARCH Venture Fund, to fund spinoffs from research based on the University of Chicago and Argonne research. And it came together. They had some successes, Illinois Superconductor, Everyday Math, which actually made money, more than the superconductors. Says Subs and Bobs and mathematicians came out. For various reasons, that model didn't work, and some variants of it, I think, are still carrying on at the university. But that was a period when we really started to try to create an innovative economy and ecosystem in Chicago. In fact, Mayor Byrne, who was mayor at the time, appointed a committee on high technology development to try to create a Silicon Valley here in Chicago, and she asked me to chair it. And we had representatives from all the universities and most of the industries, and made a number of recommendations, and some of them have now come to pass. We have a Chicago Innovation Center. It only took 25 years.
So I'm going to keep pushing along this line.
Yeah, okay.
So now you're president of the School of Art Institute of Chicago, and you have an interest in innovation at SAIC. And clearly, as you just said, the city has changed dramatically since the 80s in terms of having a really substantial, or growing, I should say, let's say, innovation ecosystem. So what have you learned now, for example, as president of SAIC that you would have liked to have known when you first came in and started thinking about innovation and making things really happen at Argonne and in the city, I guess, at some level?
First of all, I learned that all institutions, no matter how big or how small, have some of the same issues that you as president must deal with. But I've learned a lot about interdisciplinarity. You know, art and design to me is like almost science and engineering. Designers are a lot like engineers. Artists, you may not believe it, but they're a lot like scientists, specialists. And some, you know, they really are. And I could go into more detail. But the school is very interdisciplinary, SAIC, and it allows students, artists, and designers. There's a great technology base in art and design now. to work together. And looking back, if I had recognized the real value of interdisciplinary work, I probably would have tried to push more to create opportunities at the lab for that to happen. That's happening now. We have the IME, right? And a number of other programs which are by nature interdisciplinary. It was much harder at that time. DOE funding was not favorable to it because it's funded by funnels. But that's, Eric, looking back, if I had been ahead of the curve, I would have tried to create more opportunities for interdisciplinary work across the disciplines at the lab.
Well, I know one of the things that I know you are working at SAIC is with Chicago and Argonne on sort of urban design. Do you want to say a few words about this project that you're now working on with?
There are a couple of things.
The urban CCD.
Right, yeah. We're working on with Chicago and the city. One is this big data project with the University of Chicago, Argonne, SAIC. And the idea is to make it easy to use existing data that's collected by the city to help the city and the community better, manage issues from traffic problems, environmental problems, pollution, probably even crime, and looking at certain aspects, correlates between where crime takes place and other factors. And part of it, and here's where it gets tricky because people get paranoid, there are going to be little devices around the city that collect data. And they're called an array of things, and the devices, the designs we do at SAIC, the software and some of the sensors they do at Argonne, and a lot of the data analysis done through the group at University of Chicago. They do not collect data on individuals. Collect environmental data, but they're going to be very, very interested. But I have to tell you this story. It's this, second day on the job at SAIC, two faculty came to see me and said they wanted to tell me about a project they were working on. I said, okay, what is it? They said, we're working on a project with Argonne National Laboratory. And I said, why are people here at the School of Art and Design working with Argonne? I thought this had to be fate. It turned out to be. They're working on sensors for environmentally sensitive architectural designs. And the lab was working on those, and we were working on those also. So the paths have come together.
So you mentioned the challenges in multidisciplinary work before. Can you say something? As provost, I'm very interested in how artists and scientists can work together. So how is that going? Has that been a learning experience?
Actually, it's going very well. We're doing a couple of things here at the University of Chicago. You have a program on arts, culture, and science. And they bring together, this program brings together graduate students in the sciences here with students in the humanities and the arts to work on joint projects at the graduate level that are then funded. So some of you, the science students, have come down to SAIC to pair up with some of our artists and designers to work on joint projects together. One of the most fascinating has been a project between an experimental astrophysicist here and a fiber and material studies student at Chicago, at our school, where they created something called a map of dark matter, which is going to be a work of art out of fiber, but it also is revealing aspects of dark matter that Benedict, who's a student here at Chicago, says actually has helped him to get a better understanding of some of his science. That's one of the most fascinating to me. So I've become a big fan of interdisciplinary activities now across all boundaries.
So one other question about the city. We heard the mayor talk about the value of the national labs, Argonne and Fermi. MBL's a little further away, but I'm sure there's big value in the city of Chicago. And then the university having, of course, its primary presence here in the city. And you're the mayor President Zimmer talk about it. From your perspective, as a leader of the city, how do you see, and also at your time as director of Argonne, how do you see the labs, which are of course not in the city proper, having an impact here more broadly than say, just being out there in the suburbs and doing great research?
I think the mayor made the most important point to me. What the labs and the university bring to this area are people. You know, we have maybe, 3,000 scientists and engineers between the labs, probably, here, many of them, a majority at the PhD level. If you had to say to Chicago, you know, what could you do to attract over 3,000 scientists and engineers to this area? What would you create? It's not clear what they could do other than create a national laboratory or something of its equivalent. And these individuals, they don't just stay in the labs. They go into their communities, they go to schools, their parents, they belong to community organizations, they're in schools, they volunteer. So they create a sort of atmosphere that's I think we might take for granted because it's here and it's not a big device, it's not a big installation. So I started with that, Eric, the sort of creative, entrepreneurial, and intellectual energy that the people bring to the city and the area.
Okay. One other question, which you've obviously been involved in education for your whole career in various ways. You've been involved in, of course, here as the vice president for research. You were Morehouse, president of Morehouse, and now you're president of another important institute that's in education, higher education. What's your sense of how the national labs and marine biological lab can or should play a role? Their missions are primarily, of course, research and development, but what do you think of as their role in the education ecosystem, in particular those labs like ours that are run by a university?
I think primarily it will have to come through the people, the scientists being involved in educational activities. The labs can play a role, and I'm more cautious because there was a period when we tried to play a much larger role. At one time, DOE actually funded educational programs directly from the national headquarters. I think it was Admiral Watkins, the Secretary of Energy. And we would have workshops at Argonne. I would think we'd, in the summer, run 6-week workshops for high school students and teachers. So it was a direct educational role. And one can do that, but the primary mission of the labs is going to be these kinds of things Bob alluded to, running major facilities, doing long-range, high-risk research. And you don't want to have too much mission creep. But on the other hand, having said that, I think the labs can and are doing a great deal through programs that involve scientists going into the schools, involving students coming over to work in the laboratories. They're more the kind of the informal type activities. And I think that's good. Also, another thing I think the labs can do and are doing is to do these small scale activities that can be translated, can be scaled up. And I know there's some program Argonne has, which they bring students to the campus to do research, and minority students, mm-hmm. and one of the great programs. And they can only do that for a subset of students, but by doing that, they demonstrate that, in fact, these students can succeed, that they can learn science, that they love science if exposed to it in the right way, and those models hopefully could be replicated outside of the lab. So it becomes a lab in that sense also, mm-hmm. a laboratory for learning.
I mean, I actually see the labs very much as they're a potential, of course, for careers for some of our students, and we do have programs in each of the labs, as we may hear a little bit about in a little while. For example, the university has these Metcalf positions where we send our undergraduates to experience different types of potential careers for them, and one of the places we place those Metcalfs are at the National Lab. So they've been extremely helpful, and it's interesting to hear your perspective on that. I mean, is there anything else you would say about the challenges behind today by the national labs in terms of their, as Bob had mentioned, they're always close to making major sort of, they're always close to crisis at some level because of government funding, the way the government funding works today. It's in fits and starts, it's challenging. And since you've seen essentially the world in many different ways, from NSF's perspective as a head of an agency, from university perspective, I mean, what do you think, how do you think of the future of the national labs in the country in general? And really, clearly there's value, we've discussed the value, but what do you see the future with regard to how the U.S. supports them and how they're going to continue to be important in the science and technology ecosystem?
Well, the one thing I can predict is that every 3 years there's going to be a national study on the future of the national laboratories, right? I have once had a guy named Lou Branscombe, who used to be head of the National Bureau of Standards, helped found the NCAR. And he was asked to chair a task force on the future of the national laboratories. And he said, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to go back and look at all the recommendations of the last 10 task forces and cull from those. I think the laboratories are going to face some of the same challenges, government funding, the sort of restrictions on being able to be really creative within the constraints of the government agencies' missions. And that's just there. That's the world they live in. I think they're much more important. Because if you think of it, and you would know, these are sort of the last repositories of long-range basic fundamental research. You know, I mean, there's no more Bell Labs to speak of, no more IBM, they're around a little, even Motorola. You know, everybody, the big industries had nice, very good research laboratories, mm-hmm. both basic and applied. The nation doesn't have that anymore. So, and it's not all the national labs. There are only a few national laboratories, Berkeley, Argonne, probably some at Oak Ridge. You know, they're not that many, you know, five or six for the entire nation. So I think these entities are more important now for the future of the country than they've ever been.
Okay, I think that was a good way to conclude the conversation. I think we should all thank Walter for his insight.
Thank you.
Thank you, Walter.
Thank you.
So now that we've heard the view from Walter Massey, we get to hear the view from sitting lab directors. Peter Littlewood, who's currently director of Argonne National Laboratory, and maybe as I call your name, you can just come up to take a seat. Nigel Lockyer, who's director of Fermi National Laboratory, and Hunt Willard, the president and director of the Marine Biological Laboratory. Please come up and join me.
A lot of people here.
So I think I'll start these questions with Hunt, who's sitting in the middle. Hunt is a world-renowned destination for scientists and students in marine biology, ecology, global climate research. What is it you would say, and now the new relationship with the university, what is it you would say that relationship means to you in terms of partnerships, collaborations, recruiting? And maybe you can just start with a few sentences for everybody to tell us a bit about what MBL actually does. Mm-hmm.
So we've 127 years of experience at getting this right. We've got 2 years on the university, so we had a head start. But the strength of the MBL in the very tip of Cape Cod in Massachusetts has always been its ability to convene scientists and students and attract them there from all around the country, from all around the world, typically in the summer months. I can't imagine why they would pick the summer to do it, but that was historically what they decided to do. And the unique feature of it as a home of biology and a home for biological discovery was there were research laboratories that were available for scientists from all over, including the University of Chicago at its very beginnings, as Bob said in his introductory remarks, to perform what I call unencumbered research, to think completely freely, and to engage not only with their own research, but in collaborations with whoever came there that summer as well, in an age in the beginning, especially when there was very little ability to communicate. You didn't fire off an email to see who else was going to show up. You just saw who showed up. And that group would together put their minds together, literally and figuratively, and think of new projects, dream not just about what they wanted to know, but also the questions that we hadn't even formed yet. They hadn't formed yet. Thinking in a completely unencumbered way, in a way that was much more difficult to do in the sort of daily, weekly, monthly grind of the pesky day job that one was doing at their home universities. So it developed a completely open way of thinking, open both intellectually because of the unencumbered nature, but also more critically, I think, because it gave you a different group of people that were not all biologists. Many of them were, of course, given the name of the laboratory, but from many different fields who would come there for precisely the same purpose and be able to glue together, if you will, their lines of thought. A group of students at the same time were coming for the exact same purpose, to learn how to do science, how to think about science from the research perspective, and to learn subject matters by actually doing, by exploring, by developing new knowledge and learning their knowledge at that same time. So it developed a very different ethos and character at that point in time. But it was always dependent on, of the perhaps now 1,500 different scientists and students who come in the summer, largely in the summer months, it developed, it depends largely on the ideas and thought that would be brought in. And that is obviously wonderful, but it has in an age when science is moving so quickly and thought is moving so quickly, it lacks the ability to plan very far ahead. So it's that balance that one wants to get. And the University of Chicago relationship provides us precisely with that balance moment and an opportunity to bring in a group of colleagues that give us the capacity for thinking much more strategically about our future. What are the kinds of questions? What problems do we want to tackle together? Bringing a very interdisciplinary group of thinking, to piggyback on Walter's point, because of all of the expertise represented at the university. Biologists, of course, come to visit us, and biology students come to visit us, some of whom are out in the audience today. But it also attracts scientists and other scholars from very, very many different fields, thinking very differently around some of the same questions, some of the most challenging questions that will require interdisciplinary thought from many, many different perspectives. So the relationship with Chicago brings us colleagues, brings us a very deep bench, if you will, of outstanding colleagues who are motivated to want to join us in collaborative projects and think fully ahead in a very different way than I suspect they, or we, since I'm a University of Chicago faculty member as well, think when we're on this campus. But also invite students from the University of Chicago to get a very different flavor of education, to learn how to think in a very different way. And my own feeling is if students can learn that at that very early age, that then gets them for life. They now have a completely different way of thinking about research, thinking about the world, thinking about the questions that need to be addressed and the problems that need to be tackled, even long before we have the capacity to really articulate those. So my greatest hope is not just for my current colleagues here at the university, but it's for that generation of University of Chicago students, some of whom haven't even come here yet, who will be absolutely outstanding leaders and have a very different way of thinking about the world going forward.
Thanks, Hunt. Next question is for you, Nigel. Last month, the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to a few gentlemen who did atmospheric and solar neutrinos. And you, as the director of the only national high-energy physics lab, have been working in neutrinos for quite a few years. This has been a subject of interest for the laboratory and for partnerships here. What's next? How are you thinking about the future of Fermilab and neutrino physics?
Well, I
say it in a way that's, you know,
understandable.
We can all understand.
Yeah. All right, so I'll start by saying the Nobel Prize went to a good friend of mine from Canada and did an experiment which, when everybody looks at it, say to themselves, boy, that's a beautiful experiment. It was an experiment that addressed a particular question and it nailed the answer. There was just no doubt when you were finished that we understood that the sun, the model of the sun was correct and you needed to make an adjustment for the mass of the neutrinos. So that was something which people had been playing with for a long time, but all of a sudden you did one experiment, it was over budget, it was late, it was almost canceled a few times. You know, it was a big lift for Canada to launch that in a collaboration with other countries, US being one of them. But in the end it was super successful, and I think it goes back to Bob's comments this morning that experiments that are successful are always at the edge. They're at the edge of technology, capabilities. Yeah, there's a big risk there in order to be successful. So that was a great thing coming. We'd wondered if it would happen for many years. It did. And I was pleased to see it happen. Neutrinos go back at Fermilab to the very beginning. The E1A at Fermilab was a neutrino experiment.
The University of Chicago was a major player in an experiment at Fermilab, which accumulate the largest statistics of neutrino events in the world at that time, in collaboration with Columbia and Fermilab and so on. So the history's there. The question is, what's next, you were asking, and I think the question is, now that we know neutrinos have mass and neutrinos oscillate, which means they, you know, we use the analogy of an ice cream cone where you have vanilla, strawberry, chocolate, and you start off with a vanilla cone, and somehow when you put it to your mouth, it's turned into a strawberry cone, and you're a little confused. Well, that's the equivalent of the situation with neutrinos now, is that over distance, they start out as one type, and as a function of distance and time, they change into another type. They do that in free space. They do that in a way that we don't understand. And they do it over very large distances. And so you heard Bob mention that we're thinking about an experiment, which I would draw analogy to the experiment at Snow, which was, we think we're doing the experiment in this field now. We're covering a lot of bases. And it's over a distance of 1,300 kilometers. So you create what would be the world's most intense beam of neutrinos at Fermilab. You can stand in that beam. We could put this beam through this room and nobody would know. So that tells you how weakly they interact. And it goes through the Earth. And we're going to have a detector, which I would guess is maybe 10 times the size of this room, filled with cryogenic liquid, 1 mile underground, trying to detect those neutrinos and studying them. So is that something that excites the minds of students and faculty and so on? I would say yes, for sure. Is the public interested? Sort of. You know, I think they understand that they hear the word and they don't really believe it, but you know, you are being bombarded with these things all the time. We send a beam of neutrinos now to Minnesota, and they leak into Canada. The Canadians don't mind, it's okay. They don't detect them or complain. It gets through the border easier than some of us, so so it is it's an exciting field, and I think you'll see a big effort from physics department here in Chicago. We've got some young leaders in the department playing a big role in the program, so it looks like to be a good time.
So just so everybody in the audience knows, neutrinos are passing through your body as we sit here, but by very large numbers, so don't get worried. I do have a quick follow-up to that, though. When you talk about the public might sort of interested, both Argon and Fermi are as Bob said, facing major instrument upgrades or major new pieces of equipment that, if you add it all up, it's several billion dollars, so that's a lot of taxpayer money. How do you make that pitch, not just to the public, but also, you know, your biggest audience now, I imagine, is Department of Energy and Congress, but you do need to make the pitch more broadly. So in a few words as you can say it, how do you convince people that this is of fundamental importance at that cost?
You make the pitch depending on who you're talking to. So we have two senators in our state. One senator seems to be interested in the neutrinos themselves. I won't say which one's which, just to stay out of trouble. I've been asked questions like, is there a pipe between Illinois and South Dakota? And no, sir, there's no pipe for the neutrinos. They just go through the Earth. So there is a certain amount of understanding that research being done now will have some value in the future, but you don't have to worry about it now. That's one intellectual position you can take. The other position is, well, what's it good for? That's what my brother says to me, so I'm used to that question. And the quick answer is, well, you always have to go back and ask, you know, what kind of crazy things were discovered in the past, and how are they part of your daily life now? So, you know, you can say one third of the economy comes from high technology things discovered a long time ago. People love to say general relativity is used to, you know, help you with your GPS and so on. So, you know, what the Higgs boson is good for in the future, whether you'll be using neutrinos to image the center of the Earth, whether we'll use it to understand more of the inside of the sun, we don't know at this point. We just have to keep understanding more and more about you know, the world around us. And as I say, you know, make the pitch that it will be valuable at some point. Now, the other point is that you push technology doing this. You push cryogenic technology, vacuum technology, accelerator technology. You know, if I have an elevator speech about how many accelerators there are in the world, 30,000 accelerators are used. You go into a hospital, there's accelerators. You probably in these nano labs, you have small accelerators. So they're being used everywhere. And, you know, it has a big impact on society, which people don't realize until they run into them. So it's not such a hard sell when it comes down to it. One of my favorite examples was, if you have a heart attack today, we'll take you to the hospital, and all of the technology that's used there came out of particle and nuclear physics. So it'll save your life someday.
Great. That's a great argument. I hope everyone
Please
here buys it.
Please invest at the end of this.
Peter, these two labs are somewhat different than your lab. They're somewhat more focused. We have a high-energy physics lab, which is very focused, a biological research lab, which is somewhat focused. Argonne is much broader. It's focused, you know, it's got everything from computing to biology to material science, high-energy physics. But it does have an overarching mission, which is ultimately delivering on energy in the long run. Can you say a few words of how that mission actually promotes better science, and also how you're thinking about innovation in that context, mm-hmm. actually getting some of the science out to that ultimate mission, which is mm-hmm. the mission of energy. Okay.
Yeah, so Argonne, of course, was founded with a very distinct mission, and that mission is more or less unchanged, actually, over the decades, but it's interesting to see that what's happened over those years is that there have been a number of revolutions, so it was very interesting to hear Walter talk about how he led the lab in a change from being entirely focused on nuclear energy to bringing about material science to starting new facilities and very interestingly ahead of the curve at that time. So one of the things that the labs actually have to do is to keep a focus on this very distant goal, which sometimes can feel decades off. You know, I think we'll have renewable energy in this country long after Nigel's experiment on the neutrinos has revealed the secrets of the neutrinos. But that goal requires a continued vision, but a continued change in the way that you operate. So interestingly, I think you would never have predicted where Argonne is now based on where it started. You know, you begin with nuclear energy, you think you need nuclear physics for nuclear energy, but actually that's really easy. Material science is what you need for nuclear energy. And then after you develop materials and you look at materials under extreme conditions, then you discover that you need to have new tools to be able to look at those materials. And that leads you to neutron scattering and synchrotrons, and it leads you into nanoscience. And then you begin to be able to understand chemistry at the most deep level. And from the chemistry, you can then move to topics like energy storage, where, of course, Argonne over the last two decades has really built an enormous portfolio. And this is a reminder that a big lab like Argonne is always dealing with big problems, but those problems change even if the mission stays relatively straightforward. So you asked me about where do we go from here and how actually is the university and the city enabling us to take what fundamentally is our mission and actually get it to market. One of the things that happened, the Bayh-Dole Act in 1980, meant that it was then fundamentally possible to take federal research, collect that IP, license or push out that IP, and get it out into the market. But I think the labs have stumbled over a very long time about exactly how to do that, because we fundamentally face parents in DOE and in the federal government, and the federal government likes you to stay in your lane, don't cause trouble. Part of getting things to market involves causing trouble. So without the avenues actually that the university has provided with things like the Chicago Innovation Exchange, the partnership we have through IME, we would have a really huge challenge in getting there. But we've now, of course, got to the stage where you can buy Argonne technology in the Chevy Volt. The Nissan Leaf was just announced that the next version will have a 200-mile battery. And that battery and the battery technology in there was invented at Argonne. And actually, President Xi Jinping of China said, in order for China to compete in the modern world, we need national laboratories modeled on Argonne. So we've actually come, you know, a great way through this journey on that mission, which is a mission to solve technology and engineering problems for the nation and from the planet.
Thank you. So Hunt, I had another question for you. One of the distinguishing features of Marine Biological Lab, which I think is quite relevant to these other two labs as well, is as a destination to convene groups of scientists who wouldn't necessarily work together at their institutions. They're brought together perhaps around a particular subject in marine biology and ecology, environmental studies. Can you say a little bit about what that looks like, and then, you know, projecting forward in the future, how that will continue to be an important component of what Marine Biological Lab does to innovate in science, to create new, essentially new directions, new fields even in biology?
Certainly. So originally, the premise for going to Woods Hole, I made a joke about the summers being nice there, but it really was that the diversity of life in that area in the oceans was extraordinary. There, in geologic time, there's a particular convergence of two different zones. The diversity has both come and gone at various times in the intervening millions of years. And a very rich diversity that, of course, is mostly available in the summer, but there's other diversity that's in throughout the year. So that's what originally brought people there, and we've always had, and will be focusing from a strategic perspective even more, a marine resources center which goes out harvesting, collecting specimens, identifying species. There's far more species we actually have no idea what their names are that are in the oceans than the ones that we do understand. So every day is a rich harvest, if you will, of new diversity, both species known and unknown, biology both known and unimagined of. And so that's always attracted people there, both scientists and students. And we're now focusing that somewhat more purposefully in terms of the kinds of facilities that we would need, not only in a boat that goes out to do the harvesting, but the ability to bring them indoors and to build facilities there where we can maintain certain species throughout the year, develop the husbandry methods that will allow those species to be maintained, and do experiments indoors in a purposeful, truly research environment, as opposed to complement what goes on in the field, where you go out and you make observations in nature. So we see what's happening with the elevating pace of climate change. We see what happens in different ecosystems areas, both terrestrial and ocean. We can now take those ideas, bring them indoors, make changes indoors in those laboratories, and test questions in real time about what happens to organisms when you raise the pH of the water, or you raise the temperature of the water, or the nitrogen levels change, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a much more active way of doing it in a strategic way that builds on the historical founding of why the MBL was put in Woods Hole in the first place. But there are other areas that actually blend very, very nicely, particularly with argon, and we'll work hard to find a way. Well, we have plenty of neutrinos there, I hear. They go through all the time. But there's always been an enormously a great strength in imaging capacity at the MBL, where the very best in available machines, in order microscopes and other imaging capacity, as well as ones that are currently under development or just being dreamed of, where scientists, both those who are the developers as well as the biologists who want to use those and have particular questions they want to ask with that machinery, in order to learn together and to co-develop, if you will, the kinds of both technology, the way of thinking, and the necessary computation that increasingly one needs in order to get the most out of those pixels and understand exactly what it's telling us about how life works in all of the organisms in real time, from single cells to whole organisms, and be able to do that hand in glove with our other focus on marine life and the changing environment, all happening together.
Thank you. Nigel, you in a way have a similar issue to convene. Of course, people come to use your facilities, but you are the only high energy physics lab in the nation.
Not me personally.
You have Fermilab. You personally, though, have an interesting job. So your job is also to convene, and I hate to say it's to convene several thousand physicists to move in one direction, right? There's many ideas out there in science, great competing ideas in cosmology and in high energy physics, and we know there's a major collider now in Switzerland, which is dominating at the high energy end of things. How do you think about, you know, working with what amounts to many, many faculty members from across the country, including our own University of Chicago, to convene these people and get them to move in a path maybe a new science direction, like the kind of neutrino work that you described earlier?
It's not as hard as you think, actually. So particle physics is, it knows what it's doing. It's a relatively well-organized field. It knows what the big questions are. The whole idea of science being organized by big questions, I think, came out of a National Academy study the first time that Mike Turner put out, and it was the top 10 questions or something in science. And I think almost every report since then has followed that format that Mike established. So once you know the question you're trying to answer, it's really just you know calling up your friends in some sense and saying, what do you think and how should we do it? And so the challenge for the US, and it's interesting, I was listening, National Laboratories. Fermilab is desperately trying to create an international laboratory in the model of CERN in Europe. And how do you do that in the context of the Department of Energy, I'll say constraints? And what we found is the DOE is quite flexible in how they do things, that the rest of the world still looks the United States to be a, excuse me, be a leader in science. And we also have a reputation of doing big things. And so if you're going to do a big, ambitious experiment, if the U.S. gets committed to it, your friends from around the world are going to show up. And I think that's what we're finding now. I just wanted to, since I'm a slight politician, I want to answer a question you never answered, asked me, if you don't mind. So he's looking nervous now, right? So
it's called a pivot. Pivot, yeah. Nigel, and you're
pivot. Okay, pivot. I'm pivoting. Okay, just like a buffalo pivots, you know. So I just want to say that, you know, I was I did my graduate thesis experiment at Argonne, and the director of the lab was Walter Massey, and I remember as a student barely knowing what a director of a lab was, and I said, so who is this guy, and is he any good? And people said, yeah, he's not bad.
There you go. Okay, nice pivot. So,
that's the ultimate praise for high energy.
So let's turn from high energy physics to energy in the scale, which also a similar question, Peter, which is, you know, if you look at technology today, it's it is a contact sport, but it also is a very multidisciplinary and collaborative sport, and it's very hard to solve these challenges that we're all facing in energy storage and nuclear and solar, et cetera, without having really mixed teams. And by that, I don't just mean chemists and physicists, although that's already a challenge. But really, how do you get industry, universities, and national labs? And what's special about a national lab? And of course, the example being the Energy Innovation Hub, JCESR, the Joint Center for Energy Storage Research. How do you think about being a convener and a place, a destination, if you will, to bring these kinds of traditionally very competitive bodies together to work on a really big challenge?
Yeah. No, thanks, Eric. I was just thinking in Nigel's response about how easy it is to get physicists all together. Try this with chemists. It's just. I think there are important things. So I said, you know, there are big problems and there are big ideas and there are big goals associated with energy. And you can actually get people to line up behind those. But pulling a team together which can address those, and again, the Joint Center for Energy Storage Research is a good example of that, is a real challenge, because firstly, you need diversity of all kinds in order to be able to do this. You need not just the scientists and the engineers at the core of this. You need connections which get out far into the market and to understand how that works. So, the Joint Center for Energy Storage Research is grown up as a collection of research done at 5 national labs, 4 universities, 4 companies, many other partners. But of course, it's acquired a penumbra around that of places into which it sticks out. So, because the purpose of doing this research is actually to generate a prototype device, which is intended to change the world, we need to understand how it's going to fit. And we also need to pull it in to business much more rapidly than the traditional path. Walter was referring to, you know, the old industrial labs. And actually, I used to work at one, and so did Eric. And the old industrial labs,
understood their market. They understood where they were trying to get to. And by doing that, they then gave you a lot of freedom on the front end of that to explore things because you fundamentally knew where you were going. But they would also actually stop doing things quite rapidly. One of the things that we don't do very well is actually to stop. And so one of the challenges is actually stop doing something, not because the science isn't interesting, but because on a time scale of 5 to 10 years, I don't know whether this is going to go. So you begin to focus your efforts and drive it down. And then the next side of that, of course, is if you think you're getting close to something, you need to produce a really dynamic and organic bridge to the market. And the market doesn't just mean somebody who's going to license your cathode chemistry so that they can build some batteries in China. It means the very far end user, it may be Exelon, trying to think about what it's going to do as it puts wind on the grid. It may mean, you know, the venture capital folks who think that there's going to be a huge market for batteries but have no idea what a battery is and think it's some kind of app. I'm not kidding, and just don't know how to invest, right? So then, you know, you become a convener in a very different sense of bringing a different group together. And I will say, we couldn't do this at Argonne if we didn't have the University of Chicago and the city to do this, because that could bring us in through organizations like the Chicago Innovation Exchange through 1871. It's the business community in the city, people who actually have money who say, well, I'd like to put some money here, but I don't know how. And that whole ecosystem, which has really grown and developed in Chicago over the time that I've been here in the past 5 years, is really exciting. This is the place where some of those things are beginning to change.
So I'd like to turn a little bit to something which everybody has hinted at a little bit, which is the global aspects to what each of your labs do, and look at this balance between competition and collaboration, because I think, you know, certainly if you look at the world of high energy physics, you know, we know there's a great machine in Switzerland, and China's now just announced that they're on the path to a 30-kilometer machine. Energy obviously is a tremendously competitive thing, and then what you do, Hunt, of course, in environmental work and climate has clear global interest, and certainly the University of Chicago has begun to be a much more global player, thinking, of course, our scholarship has always been global, but thinking about how we position ourselves in various regions around the world to think about what's going on there, but that should go both ways. It should be collaboration, but also understand what these different important areas in the world are doing. So how do you, I mean, we can just go down the line. I'd just like to get a general comment on how each of you think in the context of your labs and the university about work, collaboration versus competition on a global scale. Maybe just start with you,
Nigel. Sure. So I would say that particle physics historically has been competitive in nature. You had competing machines at Fermilab and in Europe and in Asia. But the size of the projects are becoming so large now that you have to get everybody together to think about building one of something. And so the competition becomes not so much between each other, but how to work together. It's more of a collaborative drift into a collaboration and understanding how each country works, how each country contributes to science, how the scientists are going to work. And you desperately try not to talk about where that machine's going to be for as long as possible, because there is real life at some point. And so in our field, you mentioned China. I mean, China is looking to be on the world stage of particle physics. They don't have the technology to do that, but they can certainly dig a hole. And then they would want the rest of the world to fill it for them. So that's kind of where we are now with our discussions with China.
But we as scientists, we as a nation, of course, are competitive. And that competition's a good thing. It sharpens your thinking. It also, you know, we like to win. Everybody.
Well, we're
does,
competing
so
against
China.
Nature, so it's a different competition. Okay. Now we're just trying to figure out, you know, the secrets of nature.
You're going to stay diplomatic on
yeah,
this.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. Okay, Hunt, do you want to?
Well, biology came as a field came late to the game of collaboration writ large. It actually probably started the most famous initial effort at that was the beginnings of the Human Genome Project when I was involved in it at that stage. And the very beginning of that was quite uncomfortable. You had individuals, I mean, even the funding, the nature of funding, at least in this country and many countries, is predicated on the individual, the investigator-initiated idea, which invites you to go into your office, pull the shades down, close the door, and present your idea. So the Human Genome Project stumbled initially in the beginning because it was pulling people together to try to think of what they could do together. And what it was, well, you take the idea and you go home to your place and you do it, and someone else take it and go to their home and they do it. And that stumbled for quite a while until it became clear that the collaborative approach in developing teams in a few places, which was a much smarter idea, and the rest is, as they say, history. So the MBL's approach to that, and now with the University of Chicago, is very much along those lines. It has been predicated on the theory of collaboration, not competition, by offering something that they don't have at home. What don't they have at home? They don't have laboratories that allow some to do work with their collaborators. That's always a stumbling block in collaboration. It's collaboration by internet, it's collaboration by Skype, it's collaboration by FedEx with materials, but everyone pretty much stays in their own place. What the MBL offers increasingly is a home base for that, where everyone can come in. We're sort of the Switzerland of biology in that respect. And come there and say, we will come together, we'll work together, we'll share those ideas, and we will eventually go back to our home institutions, as will our students, et cetera. But we have a life where we're thinking of different kinds of projects that we can do together under the sort of safe haven, if you will, the safe intellectual haven and nice facilities, and in some cases, very unique facilities and offerings at the MBL. So historically, that has worked. It's working now very well with the University of Chicago, where this is another part of their safe haven in order to travel and think of different kinds of projects than they can comfortably do, easily do here in Hyde Park. And the collaborations with our own resident scientist group, who after all are the foundation that is part of the convening. They're what are in part attracting, because they work on the very same themes of climate change, environmental studies, and biological diversity.
Yeah, so of course in science, collaboration is critical, because it is the multitude of ideas, but at fundamental heart, science is at the source of a lot of the economic development. And you know, Peter, you think a lot about how science can lead to economic development, and China visiting, because they are, I know, very interested in understanding how to build national labs, as Walter said before, as a replacement, if you will, for the Bell Labs, an engine of innovation. And you can be very open and collaborative, but there is $1 billion of investment in U.S. taxpayer money in what you're doing. So how do you think about the collaboration versus the cooperation?
Right. I mean, it's complicated.
Yeah.
One has to be pretty sophisticated about this, and it's not easy. It's, I think, worth remembering that Argonne is a very international place. So partly because of our user facilities, we have 5,000 users every year coming to use the synchrotron at the APS to do science experiments, and they come from all around the world. We've collaborated in those areas for a long time. In the nuclear space, a little bit hidden from others, we've been also collaborating in a complicated space, but I think has been very productive. So in the Atoms for Peace program, actually, in the 50s and 60s, the US happily exported nuclear technology and built large numbers of high-enriched uranium research reactors around the planet. Then we decided a little bit later that having high-enriched uranium was probably not a good idea, and we needed to undo this. And Argonne has had a long program of traveling to interesting and complicated places in the world to convert high-enriched uranium reactors to low-enriched uranium reactors. And this is a long program. That's an aspect of security work where we've often been welcomed into places where we have complicated relationships, Russia, Ukraine, China, South Africa, at a time when South Africa was not really part of the international area. So, and of course, most recently, behind the scenes in the Iran negotiations, some of my colleagues at Argonne were busy redesigning a reactor from a distance in Iran to make sure that it couldn't produce weapons-grade plutonium. So we've sat in this space all the time, actually, where you're pushing an energy agenda which has global value. At the same time, you're working with people who are not always going to be, drinking buddies. And so
So that's a complicated thing that we need to negotiate. It means, frankly, that in some of these spaces, the labs have to be very sensitive to the political agendas. Sometimes we have to help drive those political agendas to do this. And I will say that it helps, for example, to be in Chicago, where, you know, if I get into trouble with China, I can talk to Hank Paulson and ask his advice. Broadly, of course, what we're trying to do are things that everybody agree will improve the planet. The way we do that is highly competitive, either intellectually competitive, financially competitive, or sometimes militarily competitive. And we just have to understand that that's the space we live in and navigate it. And as I say, it's complicated, but I think we can add a lot of value by understanding all three sides of those equations.
Thank you. So one question around workforce development that I think that all of you need to think about and probably do think about every day. The University of Chicago is producing 1,500 undergraduates every year, and we have over 9,000 graduate students, many of whom go into the academy, many of whom don't. You heard Walter say, at least in STEM, there are no more of the national labs. And I've heard, of course, that labs like Los Alamos are having to hire 400 people a year, scientists a year, just to keep this engine going. So how do each of you think about the universities, think about workforce development, think about ensuring that, you know, when you build your next machine, Nigel, you've got the physicists there to actually be using that machine? So maybe we can just have a quick conversation about that one.
Yeah, so I would say it's a continuing issue. Is sort of the people coming into the system that you want the best and the brightest. That's a standard line. And I think you do that by having the most interesting science. And if you're doing interesting things, you can almost, it's almost like a thermometer. Are the young people interested in what you're doing? Yes or no? Are they showing up? Are they there in large numbers beating down the doors? So this year we had a record number of Wilson Fellow applicants. That's our fellowship that is sort of at the assistant professor level. And so it's an indication that what we're doing is of interest. And of course, what we want is the best from around the world. So it's back to that international story. So we are going after the absolute best scientists who are excited about the science we're doing. And you do that by having an exciting science program. So that's how you get them. I don't think you don't put an ad in the paper. It's what you're doing that attracts them. They'll figure it out. And and to have a university like Chicago nearby, they're going to benefit from that. It's going to attract the best faculty. It's going to attract the best students. And you've heard me say several times, fancy coming to Chicago and having the option of going to these three labs for your summer job. I mean, it would be tremendous. And when they're finished, they have a view of the research world that's probably unparalleled.
I would agree. I think we have to have, each of us has to have a compelling and exciting and inspiring story, which is aspirational in a sense, because that's where the next generation of students at whatever age are going to hang their aspirations, is on that. We have different, we would answer that question differently. And for us, there, at one level, it's trying to understand the processes of life, which is a never-ending story. We get deeper and deeper into the ability to explore that. But every time we turn a corner, you find four more doors and four more corners. At the other end, there are compelling problems like climate change and its impact on the environment and on those of us who live in that environment. That is itself compelling in a very different and much more pressing way. So every one of those stories, if they're told in a compelling way, will attract people to it, much like, again, in my own stage, when the Human Genome Project was unfolded, that was our moonshot. We called it that. That was our moonshot that would attract a generation of young biologists, and thankfully, non-biologists who came in to lend their extraordinary interdisciplinary talent to it, that allowed that project to succeed. But it was the inspirational moment of our moonshot. And that always inspires the next generation. And then our job is just to keep people inspired and we're competing, if you will, with other really good, bright ideas that are just as inspiring, just as challenging, and just as inviting for really bright and inquiring minds. And I heard, this is secondhand, so if I get the quote wrong, I'll blame the person I heard it from. But I heard that Bill Gates said that if he was going to learn how to be Bill Gates again, he would have been born a biologist. I like that quote, so I'm going to use it from now on. So.
Yeah. You also actually directly have, one second, Peter, you also directly have started an undergraduate program, right, at MBL.
Right, which, so as which, I said in one of my previous answers, we're starting as young as possible. I think that's where you inculcate this way of looking out to the world, a sense of wonderment, of sort of saying, how does something work? The older you are as a scientist, you're focused much more on sort of what the needs are of that particular project. But we all started out just sort of looking at the world and going, how the heck does that work? And that's the moment to capture students at whatever age and bring them in. It's a particular challenge in certain areas with students who are underrepresented in the sciences and in STEM fields generally, so we need special attractions there. But I think starting as young as possible, the better, and it certainly is what we're doing here with Chicago undergraduates. We've also, we had a great visit from the lab school students who came this fall. We'll go as young as we can go if it gets them hooked on the kinds of questions that we want them to be hooked on.
I would just comment that the program that you had this past fall called The Whale was sort of distinctively University of Chicago, combining reading a book, classic book called Moby Dick, and studying marine biology. So I thought that was just a brilliant, innovative move that will definitely excite our students.
Well, it was more than that, and you'll hear from those. Their students are still in Woods Hole while we're here, but these were non-biology students who were taking essentially a quarter abroad, but abroad, some people think Woods Hole is abroad, so that worked very well. We took them into the laboratory and introduced to many of them the first time they'd held a pipette, had to pipette liquid and make it work. And they were scared to death the first day. But by the third day, the fourth day, they were designing their own experiments. They were doing experiments. They were fearless. They were given permission to fail that we all learned ourselves, but we gave them permission to fail and realized that, in fact, they could generate new knowledge. There was no answer in the back of the book. That's the ultimate attraction to doing scientific research, is you write your own book as you go. And it was eye-opening for them, and I'm sure you'll hear from them when they come back to campus.
And I know you're training them to be safe in the laboratory. Peter.
Well, yeah, what I say, I'm still scared of pipettes, actually. But, of course, I agree with everything that's been said about the importance of big challenges and getting people excited on this. A few reminders from us are just sort of thinking about a large workforce and the environment that we're in. It's already the case in the U.S. that minorities are a majority in school. By 2050, minorities will be a majority of part of the general population. And by 2050, probably more than 50% of young people under the age of 21 will be in Africa. We, of course, have a global population of folks who work at Argon. We're sort of globally dispersed. About 50% of our postdocs are from Asia. Turns out. So we want to be here in 2050, and we want to have all of the folks who were not at Argon and those demographic groups that need to partake of all of the things that we find exciting, and I have to say that we're still leaving a lot of them out. The things, however, that the University of Chicago is doing both globally and locally are things that we need to learn how to benefit from, whether it's Chicago being in Beijing or India, or whether it's the great new program that Chicago is engaged with the African Institute of Mathematical Sciences, or whether it's things we're doing in our local communities here to make sure that everybody grows up together with these great deal of inspirations. And I think that actually has to be a critical thing that we take on together in a partnership, and we are doing so.
Thank you, Peter. So we have a few minutes for questions from the audience. So I'd like to invite you, in particular invite the first person. Yes.
Peter just made the point of global issues and minorities. My concern at the moment is that we have a schedule of 12 speakers, the first 8 of whom are male, and the last 4 of whom are female. I think we still have a problem in that area. Would anyone care to address that?
What can I do other than agree with you? So thank you for the comment.
I I was curious on what you all thought about the role of the national labs in public education, because as you know, funding is the key bottom source of everything, and if we have politicians who are doing whatever, who don't believe in climate change and all these things, do you think that the national labs should play a larger role in helping to shape public opinion that would in turn lead to decisions in Congress?
I can try taking that. So we have a number of constraints. One of the advantages we have, of course, is I'm not a Fed. I'm not a federal employee. So that allows me to say things that are different from what I could say if I was a federal employee. However, I'm not completely unfettered in terms of what I can say and argue for, because I can't go to Congress and lobby. We can go to Congress and educate, and we try and do a lot of that. So, and I think getting, now, by the way, if I turn up and try and educate in Congress, doesn't go so well, because they say, well, he needs $750 million next year. I know why he's here. If you go, or if our staff scientists go, or if the whole academic community goes, it does actually make a difference. And there are many routes to doing that. And I think it requires you to actually do more than turn up for a day and chat. It requires a kind of continued pressure to be able to do this, to have people donate their time and do it in a consistent manner to do this.
I'd also like to add to this, because it's a great question, in terms of advocacy, which is an interesting question. But I think where there's tremendous power here is in the partnership between the labs and the university, where the labs are very good at providing data on measurements, and have been for many years looking at not only alternative low carbon producing energy, but also measuring what's up in the atmosphere, how much carbon, how it flows, and we have people here who actually do that. The university, of course, has policy people. We've got a program called the Energy Policy Institute at Chicago, as you know, which is a somewhat different take on thinking about the globe and looking at policy and effective policy. And so ultimately what we're about is if you will, data-driven policy. The combination of the labs and more social sciences here at the university has and will continue to be, I think, a powerful way, not necessarily to get the word out, but actually impact the way, for example, countries like India and China even think about what they deploy in context of their energy systems. So it's a great question. I mean, the advocacy piece is important, but more important, I think, is the underpinning science and policy that actually relates to having an impact, and we work on that.
I could give a more general response to that. So we have, because I agree, this notion of educating the public, although we have to do that at the same time we're doing everything else that's going on. So at the MBL, we do have a science journalism program each summer in which we bring in science journalists. You won't be surprised, perhaps, to find out that most science journalists didn't start as scientists necessarily. They weren't themselves directly involved in research. And we just stick them in the laboratory. You think it's funny watching undergraduates learn to pipette. You should stick journalists in the laboratory. And they actually spend a good number of weeks there doing different kinds of experiments and understanding what the actual act of research is, so that they can hopefully better tell their stories when they return to their day jobs as journalists. And I should have said, when I was just answering Eric's question about the University of Chicago undergraduates in my answer, because they're, as I said, they're non-biology majors who are learning how to do research. I'm not so naive, I'd be thrilled if one or two of them actually decide now to say, great, I want to be a biology major. But the real payoff there is we will now have 8 or 10 other graduates from the University of Chicago who will go off into whatever fields they've decided to specialize in, but they will have a fundamental understanding of the scientific process, the research process, what it means when they read an article in the New York Times or the Chicago Tribune that describes some scientific discovery. They'll have a respect for data. And a respect for the process of getting data, which to me is invaluable. And we need to do a much better effort at getting a much broader and wider number of people to think that and be aware of that. That's why there's people who don't, quote, believe in science, because they have no idea what science is. So it's much easier to say I don't believe in it than it is to actually try to get into that.
John?
Another advocacy question. At least two of you seem to have been born outside the United States. And you mentioned, Peter, that the number of Asians who are now at Argonne.
how do we solve this immigration issue of retaining these people who come into our institutions? And are we adequately advocating for immigration reform as a set of institutions?
I'm not sure I want to touch that. I mean, I suppose I actually think that the real way you do that is actually what I'm concerned about, I'll say it in a narrow sense, is that we have all of these wonderful people who travel from around the world to come and work at Argonne, to come and work at Fermilab, to come at MBL and the University of Chicago. I'd like some of them to stay here. Right. So there's a very local issue in making sure that we have a pipeline so that these folks, for whatever they want to do, science, entrepreneurship, energy, you know, do that in the region, because that will bolster us. The point that the mayor made right at the start is that, you know, that we have, thank goodness, an overpopulation of people with degrees. We need to make sure that pipeline works more smoothly. And I think, you know, I also rely, I think, very much on the policy side coming from the university to be able to drive things, as Eric said, that I really can't talk about, and I wouldn't want to talk about, and I'm not qualified to talk about. So that's something where I think the university can help by looking at these partnerships.
I'd just like to comment that I think it's a more complicated question, because not born in the United States, so I can maybe speak freely about this, but the issue within the DOE National Laboratory System is that there's quite a spectrum of laboratories, I would say, from the Fermilab end, where it's completely open. We'd like to be completely open to the ones that are quite closed. So even for us, in an open environment, we don't have a fence, for example. You can walk into the laboratory, you can ride in on your bicycle. We have very constraining rules from the Department of Energy on which nationalities can come into the laboratory. So just getting beyond that would be a big start, I think, for welcoming people to stay here. If other people look and see that their friends cannot get in easily, why would they want to stay? So I think we can start fairly small, and by small I mean within just our own business, and try and argue for an open environment at our laboratory. So it's Fermilab tries to be more CERN-like, where anybody can go into CERN. We're struggling to get to that point. That's something we have to achieve in the next few years if we're really going to meet our goals. So it goes a long way back to the beginning of how welcoming are we as a nation, and we live in a complicated society now, and we're in the middle of it, I would say.
Yes.
I'm a fourth year in the college studying math and physics. I want to thank the woman in the front for starting this conversation about climate change. And my question is a continuation of that, and it's also related to the message of the protesters from earlier this morning. So my question is, how can UChicago reconcile the contradiction between participating in climate science research discussed here today and also investing in fossil fuel companies that perpetuate climate change?
Shall I help you out?
Yeah.
I mean, so you know, look, Argonne, you know, we try and talk about a lot of the green stuff we do, but you should understand, you know, that one of the histories of the DOE is that we really helped invent fracking, right? The next thing to talk about is how long it will take to get to that sustainable nirvana, and I often give lectures on this. And I will tell you that if we decided just to go green tomorrow, we cannot do it, right? So we need a path which makes sense, which drives things in a sustainable fashion. And then, you know, who do we need to pull on with that? Well, it's actually the people who already have money, and some of them are oil companies. So we need to be actually working with those folks to drag them to make sure that there's a way that they can take that money and invest it in ways which over the next two or three decades will get to addressing some of those issues. If we just go in opposition, there's a strong risk. If we win, then you need to get used to wearing a lot more clothes, because the heating is going to get turned down, and there'll be a large amount of disruption. More likely, we will lose. Now, I'm not going to take a position on the university's investments. But I do want to say that firstly, the debate we should be having about this is a really exciting and interesting and important one, and universities are just the place to have it. But also, we cannot turn this stuff on overnight. So there's a long route that we need to plan. It actually needs consensus to develop in the whole of society. And that's the kind of thing that we can promote and that we can do within a university context, because that's the best kind of thing that universities can do.
Yes? Yeah, one more question.
Hi. Well, obviously the public invests, in the national laboratories for lots of reasons, creating new knowledge, but also the impact of that new knowledge and technology on society, such as quality of life and the economy. So, obviously I know that's important to you, and there are various vehicles for the public-private partnerships that have devolved over the past decades, and I'm wondering what you've learned from that and how you see that going forward. What we can do better.
There are many things we can do.
I was going to take the easy answer because there's relatively fewer, but we're just beginning the sort of public-private partnerships in areas of biology. There are some. Part of it is a culture shift, which will generational timing will probably take care of that eventually. But it's also fundamentally different funding models and the notion of how we approach funding the biological landscape of in biology and biomedicine in this country versus the private enterprises and how they would look at solving a problem. I mean, the notion of fundamental science, which as a biologist I buy into intrinsically, that it will take, there's no guarantee that anything we discover will have value as we go forward. Some part of it, no doubt, from a probabilistic standpoint will, but you don't make a discovery in order to try to solve some particular problem. We're trying to contribute to the underlying scientific understanding that surrounds that problem and thus will inform those who eventually, thankfully, are working very hard in order to translate those fundamental findings into something where we can impact the question at hand. So the question really is, how far apart are those? Do you think fundamental science and the translation science are this far apart, in which case bridging that gap is going to be extremely difficult? Or can we start a dialogue that over time will get those to realize that there is a continuum? You may not know exactly which dots to connect, but to get from this dot to that dot, fundamentally, and that's what the knowledge enterprise, the knowledge economy actually does. And to get a broader understanding of that so there's greater contribution in both directions. Fundamental scientists who at least are willing to think on occasion about how that might be valuable to other groups who are much closer to this end of the equation, and those who are at the private end of the equation looking back and having respect for fundamental science and fundamental biology in my world, recognizing that filling that vessel can only be helpful, and keeping that vessel empty can only be harmful to eventually finding the solutions to the questions at hand.
Okay, I think with that we will finish. There's coffee and refreshments out back, and we're coming, I think we return in about 15 minutes sharp. Thank you. Welcome back. It is now my distinct pleasure to introduce Matthew Terrell, who's a chemical engineer who's done pioneering work in biomolecular engineering and nanotechnology. He's the founding Pritzker director of the Institute for Molecular Engineering, one of the two major programs that are housed in this building, as many of you know. And just recently, just a month ago, Matt was also appointed as a deputy lab director at Argonne. So he's straddling, great example of someone who straddles both worlds and impacts both in a deep and important way. So his appointment really will help strengthen exactly what we're talking about, which is thinking about how do we co-develop scientific ideas, how do we co-develop technology, and think about how we use in both institutions to recruit the very best talented students, faculty, and staff in the years to come. So with that, I'd like to invite Matt to come up to the podium to introduce his set of speakers. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Eric. As Eric said, as of September 1st, I hold the dual role of director of the Institute for Molecular Engineering, which is both a campus and a laboratory activity. But on September 1st, I also became the deputy director for science at Argonne, which gives me a very special and hopefully influential role to play both on the campus and the lab to focus on campus university, laboratory university partnerships. The Institute for Molecular Engineering may not be a familiar term to you. We are developing a unique, distinctive approach to engineering research and education at the University of Chicago. We're talking about engineering not just of molecules, but of systems from the molecular level up. And, sorry, this is going on without me. And the idea is really to work on engineering problems that incorporate building blocks that have interesting electronic, chemical, biological, mechanical, optical properties into systems that can affect things from healthcare to computing to energy systems. We're really trying to transcend traditional engineering boundaries. My attitude is, and my colleague's attitude is, that the discipline is engineering. We're trying to focus at the interface between molecular level science and invention and application, and introduce the idea of translation of those things across the science engineering boundary. If you look at what our organization looks like right now, we have six themes in the Institute for Molecular Engineering, and if you go from the upper right-hand corner and go around counterclockwise, we have programs on soft materials that are applied to everything from computer chips to advanced energy materials, engineering water resources, quantum information, which is the next frontier of information technology and computing, a bioengineering program that's focusing on immunology and cancer, and an arts, sciences, and technology program in which we hope to convey the distinctive ideas in engineering that we're trying to develop to a larger community. We've appointed 12 faculty so far in the Institute for Molecular Engineering on the way to an early mandate of 25, although I think we might eventually exceed that if we continue to be successful. And 8 of those faculty members have joint appointments at Argonne. And that means, among other things, that they are pursuing DOE-supported programs as Argonne scientists and really integrating ourselves with Argonne. And at the same time that Argonne is helping us hire faculty, we are, I think, being effective in some cases in helping Argonne hire the scientists that we want. And I really would like gradually to drop labels of where people came from at this interface and have a broad overlapping spectrum of Argonne scientists and university faculty members who are both and participate fully in both places. So this has been an effective mechanism for joint hiring. What are we doing about this? Well, beyond the Institute for Molecular Engineering, in my role as Deputy Director for Science, there's a spectrum of University of Chicago Argonne projects. For example, the University of Chicago operates 3 beam lines at the Advanced Photon Source. One focusing on geology and earth sciences, one focusing on biological sciences, and one focusing on chemistry and material sciences. We call this CARS, the Center for Advanced Radiation Sources. The Argonne and the Institute for Molecular Engineering have offices next door to one another in the Chicago Innovation Exchange over on 53rd Street, which represents one aspect of the increasing footprint of Argonne in the city. A major program on computational material science was just funded via Argonne, including a spectrum of University of Chicago scientists and led by Julia Galli, who's one of these IME scientists that is functioning both at Argonne and at the university. We also, in the area of water, have launched some major international collaborations, including our collaboration with Ben-Gurion University, which has three elements in the molecular engineering of water resources, one program on catalysis for water purification, another program on membranes for water purification, and a third on hydrology, tracing the movement of water through soil, which can be very important. And then at a more grander scale, and you've heard from Nigel and others, there's a big cooperation, especially in the area of detectors for the South Pole Telescope and looking at the cosmic microwave background. And then finally, some broad cooperations in the area of urban science that you're going to hear more about in a couple of minutes. So we're really trying to, with this particular thing and other things that we're doing, add impact to the region in areas of technology. And I won't reiterate all of these things that are there, but they do span activities from the joint hiring that I emphasized, the upgrade of the advanced photon source, initiatives that Peter is leading, and we have a new neuroscience research institute on campus in neuroscience, water, materials computation, and so on. So with that, I want to turn the floor over in the next part of this program to four distinguished scientists and researchers who are breaking new ground in several of these areas and laying the foundation for new discoveries that could quite possibly be revolutionary in their areas. So our first speaker is Marcela Carena. Marcela is the Director of International Relations and head of the Theoretical Physics Department at Fermilab. She's also a professor in the Physics Department, the Enrico Fermi Institute, and the Kavli Institute for Cosmological Physics here at the University of Chicago. Marcela is a theoretical particle physicist who has developed a leading theory to explain the matter-antimatter asymmetry observed in the universe, which is being tested at CERN. And she has worked closely with experimental physicists at CERN and at Fermilab, creating and implementing strategies for discovery and testing new ideas about particle physics. She was a pioneer in exploring the complementary interplay between direct searches for dark matter in deep underground experiments and searches for Higgs bosons at the Large Hadron Collider. Marcela has served as a general counselor and executive board member of the American Physical Society. She's also served on the Particle Physics Project Prioritization Panel, as well as on a number of advisory panels in Europe and Latin America. Please help me welcome Marcela to the podium.
Thank you, Matt, for this nice introduction. Good morning. It is a pleasure to be here today at the University of Chicago to celebrate the 125th anniversary and to tell you briefly about my research. And I need to get the way to change these slides. Science that matters to anyone driven by the curiosity to understand how our world works is the type of awe-inspiring science that we do at Fermilab in partnership with the University of Chicago and also with Argonne. I have vivid in my mind the image of kids staring at the grandness of our universe. I grew up in one of the most southern countries of the planet, in Argentina, and every summer I could go to the countryside, to the Argentinian Pampas, and there in the deep darkness of the night, my cousins and I would sit exactly like these kids and would be amazed by the stars. And we were about 6 years old, so we knew basically nothing about the science behind these stars, but it was really breathtaking. Today, as a scientist, and most of my adult life, I have had the pleasure or the privilege to be thinking about the big mysteries of particle physics. So what causes the particles like the quarks and electrons that everything is made of to be massive and to slow from moving at the speed of light? If they were moving at the speed of light, the universe the way we know it today would not exist. The Higgs boson is at the core of all of it, and here we see actually a Higgs boson transforming into two particles of light, two photons. So what holds the universe together and produce these distorted images of the distant galaxies? We call it dark matter, and we don't have a clue what it is. Next, Nigel already talked about this. I mean, the neutrinos are everywhere, and they are very hard to detect. But also, most important, they could hold the secret to our existence. That means why there is matter rather than nothing. So, of course, as a theorist, I can think about all these big questions, but in order to, I can provide explanations, but in order really to understand if my explanations make any sense, we really need technology innovation. And this means advanced accelerators and ultra-sensitive forefront detectors. At Fermilab, the Fermilab Accelerator Complex is actually the largest in the US and the second largest in the world. And Fermilab is leading the world in superconducting magnet and radio frequency technology. And this is essential in accelerating particles as the protons that we see moving here around this circle. And here we see Energy Secretary Moniz visiting Fermilab and talking to accelerator scientists at my institution. The discovery of the Higgs boson was made possible because of these two most powerful cameras in the world, that is the ATLAS detector and the CMS detector. Chicago and Argonne play a leading role in building and now operating and upgrading the ATLAS detector, and similar situation is for Fermilab vis-a-vis CMS, the other big detectors. These are six-story high apparatus that actually weight like the Tour, the Eiffel Tower, not the Tour Eiffel, the Eiffel Tower. So these are huge, complex objects with cutting-edge technology, and what they do is they take pictures of the collisions. They actually take 20 million pictures per second in three dimensions. So they are really very impressive. So it took. Here I would like to show you a small movie, a cool movie, I think, about how the particles collide, in this case, inside the ATLAS detector and inside the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva, Switzerland. And let me remind you that this is the most complex, most expensive, and most ambitious machine ever built by mankind, and by womankind, too. I hope I can switch. OK, here, I guess, it starts. So what we do is we really recreate the conditions of the early universe, basically instants after the Big Bang. And in reality, we create the Higgs particle. So we are now moving, crossing the frontier between France and Switzerland. And here is a proton with the quarks inside, traveling basically at almost the speed of light, moving in the LHC tunnel, and arriving to the ATLAS detector. And there encounters another proton coming from the other side. And kaboom, they collide. And they have a lot of energy, so they produce a lot of particles. And among those particles, they actually produce a Higgs boson that, in this case, is decaying to two electrons that are the green tracks here and two muons that are the blue tracks here. So we have really produced the Higgs boson, as you see. So actually, it took half a century, thousands of people, and billions of dollars to prove this beautiful idea of Mr. Higgs about an invisible field that is related closely to the Higgs boson and that explains why all particles acquire mass. It took me 25 years to be modeling this type of thing, so I'm also very happy about the discovery. And I was very fortunate to meet Mr. Higgs at the Nobel Prize ceremony about 2 years ago. And on that occasion, he was telling me, as they took this picture, that his first paper on the Higgs boson was rejected because it was not sufficiently interesting for physics. So you can see that communicating basic science can be quite challenging, even when you are doing it with your peers. So after after the Higgs boson discovery, the next breakthrough would actually be to understand the identity of dark matter. And so what distorts the images of distant galaxies? Maybe if we look at this picture that we all know, we see that the projection or the reflection of the buildings is actually distorted because of the curve of the surface. Well, a similar thing happens here, but what happens is that there's matter that we cannot see, that we call dark matter, and what it does is distorts space and time because of its gravitational interactions, and in such way, light is bended as it travels to us. Okay? So dark matter holds the universe together. Dark matter makes 85% of all the matter in the universe, so that's really amazing. And we don't have the slightest clue what it's made of. But of course, theories are very inventive. So there are many flourishing ideas. Some of them, this is called a WIMP, weakly interacting massive particle, and was actually invented the concept and idea by Professor Michael Turner here at the University of Chicago. I myself have been working on these ideas quite a long time. And so I would be very excited if we finally pin it down. But the way to pin down the existence of dark matter is, again, going back to ultra-sensitive detectors. And Fermilab and the University of Chicago are really partnering in this hunt for the dark matter. So all these are different, four different experiments that are deep underground that are trying to detect dark matter coming from space. And these are very different technologies, all of these, some of them quite complex. And this one in particular, and my friends at Fermilab gave me this thing here. So this is the same, this is a CCD, as we see here. And this technology is exactly the same technology that you have in your mobile phones, and that allows you to take beautiful pictures. So some of them are really simple. So, wow. I cannot break it. besides trying to detect the dark matter that is hitting us from space, the other thing we are doing, we are actually trying to create, to manufacture the dark matter in the laboratory, the same way as we did with the Higgs boson. So again, here at the LHC, we are trying to manufacture dark matter, but although these detectors are super sensitive, they are not sensitive enough to see the dark matter because dark matter interacts very lightly with any particle that we know. So the idea is that what we'll see could be an event of this type where we detect something going on in one side of the event and nothing going on in the other. So it's this imbalance that will allow to say that this could be a detection of dark matter at a lab. So I would say that it's very hard to predict how our basic science will impact society, and I shall refer to that a bit. But I think that particle physics has a very strong track record. And in fact, we see here the Fermilab Tevatron. About 30 years ago, the technology that was developed at the Fermilab Tevatron enabled the industrialization of MRI medical scanners that are today allowing us to basically study the anatomy and understand many of the diseases or the issues that are inside human bodies. Another very interesting example is also appear around the same time, and is related to these protons, a beam of hope. So Fermilab scientists designed and built the first proton therapy accelerator for cancer treatment, and that this was actually when it was still at Fermilab, and then it was sent to the Loma Linda facility. And today, this type of least invasive type of cancer therapy is utilized in about 50 facilities or more around the world. So to conclude, I would like also to stress the relevance of introducing youth to the world of science. And I could say that Fermilab, I'm very proud to say, that I think Fermilab is doing its very strong share in that by pairing with parents and with University of Chicago and with other institutions in all the Chicago area. So thank you, and I will be glad to take your questions.
We have about 5 minutes for questions, so please. How does someone get started at the scale of science that you're talking about here? I mean, you know, Hunt was talking about people learning to use pipettes, but they got to learn a little something more to do some of the experiments that you're talking about. What's an apprenticeship like in your field?
Yeah, I could say I was actually, about a week ago, I was at the United Nations with Nigel, and there was a symposium, a one-day symposium about CERN and its global, you know, the global model, and how to, for example, relate it to other global goods for humanity. And what was discussed there is related to your question, is the fact that, you know, for example, the Large Hadron Collider involves about 3,000 scientists in each of these experiments that I show, LHC and ATLAS, about 40 countries, and more than 100 or 180 institutions around the world. And this is done really with very light structure, unlike in any other you know, industry or any other, I think, type of endeavor in the world. And I think the reason for that is that the scientists are just moved by the passion of learning. And so although there are very, there are basically no legal bindings, we are all working together for in this competition and collaboration that was discussed before here, but in a very, I would say, healthy competition, because we are just moved by trying to understand this, the way the world works. And so I think that's the reason that this started and have been developing, and it's an amazing psychological
I can imagine.
Effect to be studied.
Please.
Could you develop technology such as this
Sorry?
Source that is, you know, used by or used for cancer therapy? Is that a process for commercialization that is more push or pull? Meaning, does the laboratory push the technology mm-hmm. into the commercialization, or do the commercial partners pull it? Does that make sense?
I think it was, this was 30 years ago, and I was not here, so I don't know all the details, but I was not here in Chicago, I mean. not that I'm so young. But actually, what I want to say is that as far as I have read about this, this was an idea that came, you know, with Robert Wilson and others at Fermilab, and they realized that this was a possibility, okay, to have this proton cancer therapy instead of being as invasive as the X-rays or so, where you basically hit the whole body in the hope of, you know, hitting the cancer cells. This is much more target. So they thought they could do that. And I guess they built the accelerator that proved that that can work. That was the first one. And then I think that, you know, that idea was put into function at the Loma Linda facility. But then afterwards, the companies start thinking about this and you know, pulling, you would say, the pulling effect that you are talking about, correct? So it's a bit of how you do the intertwine between basic science and applications to society. The same thing was with MRI, correct? Fermilab actually developed these superconducting wires in order to build the superconducting magnets. And then the fact that that was made easy and cheaper, so to say, led you know, General Electric to go to the industrialization. And then that's the reason why we now have today MRIs basically in almost or most hospitals in the world, correct? So it's a very It depends on the situation, but it's an intertwined relation between push and pull.
I think there's time for one more question, so Eric's getting it.
So I'm a materials physicist, so I'm interested in a materials question. So it's amazing that you think about creating this dark matter in the laboratory, right? Most of this is, it's all out there in the universe. And so there are two approaches. You can look into the universe and see the matter, the mass or matter out there. You try to create in the lab. How will you actually know you've created the same thing in the lab at CERN that you have out in the universe?
That's a great question. I'm very thankful, because for that you need theorists. So that justifies my existence. Yeah, basically, you know, you have a model, correct? And if you detect this type of events I show at LHC, would you believe that you have detected that matter? No, okay? It would fit my model, maybe. I will tweak my model till it fits, okay? Because that's what I'm paid for. But then, you know, then I know, I mean, you know, science is very rigorous. Then I know that if that model explains what I see at LHC and fits with the dark matter explanation, then I should be able, by the same token, to go to these experiments deep underground, and the dark matter that is hitting us should also behave in a way that my model predicts. So in this, we are putting the pieces together, correct? And really the theorists are actually useful.
Thank you very much, Marcel. I'd now like to introduce Leah Gazowski, who's the Director of Strategy and Research Programs and Energy Policy Scientist at Argonne National Lab and a fellow of the Computation Institute, which is another institute that spans Argonne and the University of Chicago. Leah's work focuses on solving pressing challenges in energy and global security. She develops methods, tools, and analyses to inform energy security issues with an emphasis on economic, policy, climate change, and geopolitical concerns. She leads the System Science Initiative at Argonne, where urban science is a key focus area. Her prior work has spanned private industry and international trade development and policy. So please help me welcome Leah to the podium.
Thank you, Matt, and thank you to the University of Chicago for hosting this event today. It is truly my pleasure to be here with friends of these world-class institutions and to provide a very small overview of what is truly an enormous global challenge and opportunity, that is urbanization. So I'm here today to talk about the promise of science and engineering alongside close interdisciplinary partnerships to improve upon one of humans' greatest inventions, and that is cities, or as what we refer to as urban system science and engineering. So unlike some of the other talks that you'll hear this morning, this is not a traditional scientific discipline, nor am I a traditional scientist. But this is a relatively new endeavor, given recent advancements, particularly in data and technologies. So when I first started thinking about urban systems, I did what almost all of us here in this room would do, and that is I read a lot. I read everything I could get my hands on about what's been done and what's been written in the urban science space. And there was one line that really truly captured my imagination. And I want to share that with you today because maybe it will do the same for you. And that is, a city is first and foremost a social reactor. It works like a star, attracting people and accelerating social interaction and social outputs in a way that is analogous to how a star compresses matter and burns brighter the faster and bigger they are. These are two images that I found almost artistic in some ways. On the left, of course, you see an image from NASA of stars, and on the right, you see Tokyo. So I think that this is one way to start framing the discussion and start thinking about what is it that we truly know, or maybe don't know, about the cities that we live and work and play. Now, of course, the mathematics are quite different, but nonetheless, I think it's an inspirational way to talk about cities and truly frame some outstanding questions. So my objective here today is that you will leave here thinking of cities as more than just places that you live, but cities are complex networks of systems that include flows, relationships, and interconnectivity in time and space. So you might be thinking to yourself, cities have been around for a very long time, so why now? So let's try to build a framework for this conversation. So if we go back 150 years, there's an interesting story to tell, and we hear this quite a bit, that urbanization is happening now. But I actually want to offer all of us a bit of a dose of humility this morning. Quite frankly, urbanization has been going on for a very, very long time. It was approximately 12,000 years ago that humans figured out how to farm and domesticate animals, and that truly enables all of us to be here today because we no longer have to hunt and gather for our food, and that allowed us to actually create cities. So we see the first cities starting to move a very, very long time ago. Now, of course, you can read these statistics, but nonetheless, we see urbanization happening at a rate that has never been recorded in history, and this is mainly in the developing world. So, needless to say, that this urbanization across the globe will require thousands of decisions to be made in a very short amount of time that will impact citizens for generations to come. It is therefore crucial that these tools are available to decision makers to create the best urban centers that we possibly can. So, the panel earlier talked a little bit about China, which I think is great and timely. To put that into perspective a little bit, it's going ahead without me too. In 2025, approximately 70% of Chinese people will live in cities with 1 million people or more. And by 2030, 221 Chinese cities will have 1 million people or more. So, of course, we know that there's a strong push in China to actually add city dwellers. They are moving approximately 400 million city dwellers, moving rural people into cities. And if we put this into greater context, that means that China will need 40 billion square meters of floor space in the next 20 years if they are successful in doing this. This means the equivalent of adding one New York every 2 years. So I have another confession to make here today, and that is that cities for the sake of cities doesn't really get me that excited about the research, but cities are key drivers of some of the most critical issues facing humans. And for the purpose of this morning, I selected three that I am personally most passionate about. The first one is climate disruption. And why that? Well, it's widely reported that cities produce 70 to 80% of greenhouse gases. Yet this doesn't always give the full picture. In many ways, city dwellers are often less carbon intensive than rural and/or suburban residents. And the way that we develop cities in the future will be the key challenge, and we think science and engineering can play a key role in designing these cities. Moreover, we know that cities across the world are setting goals to reduce carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gas emissions, yet this is very difficult to quantify, measure, and track, and we think science can help with that. Next, energy security. In the United States, for example, we have about 640,000 square miles of transmission lines. The issue with this infrastructure is that it is dated in many ways, and it's poorly equipped to handle new technologies and consumer interests, such as distributed generation. We think science can help. And then lastly, economic vitality, which was talked a little bit about earlier as well. On average, as a city size increases, per capita socioeconomic quality, such as wages, GDP, number of patents produced, number of educational and research institutions, all increase by approximately 15% more than their expected linear growth. Same thing for some of the negative things, like crime, traffic congestion, but we think science, along with our partnerships, can help. So the takeaway here is that given cities' critical nature, we need to look at cities as multi-scale, complex, dynamic, and interconnected systems. Science and engineering can help, but what does it actually look like? So I'd like to present to you today some examples of the work that's going on at Argonne and with our partners. It was very hard to present some of these examples because there's so much going on in these spaces, but I selected examples that are unique to Chicago. So the first one that I'd like to talk a little bit about is our role in a great project in partnership with ComEd. They're the ones leading this project. This is looking at a way to develop an advanced microgrid. And what's especially unique about this project is that it is linking two microgrids together. So there's an existing microgrid at IIT, and there's a new microgrid being built in the Bronzeville area. And our goal is to develop the advanced algorithms and modeling to be able to do this in a new and different way. So I also talked a little bit about climate change. So one of the things that I think is most interesting at the work that we're doing at the lab is an ability to model climate change at a more granular level. So one of the things that we did when we went out and we started talking to cities was we said, what are you thinking about? What are you worried about? Without a doubt, the cities that we talked to said, we're worried about climate disruption. We know it's real. We know it's happening. We don't know what that means for my city. So what we were able to do is use what's called representative concentration pathways, which is essentially greenhouse gas concentrations and trajectories that were adopted by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So we did this for the Midwest region. We could definitely get more into this, but suffice to say that if there is no change in greenhouse gas concentrations, the Midwest region will look both warmer and wetter as we go forward. If we break that down to Chicago, even more specifically, we can actually see some different scenarios in data. Again, the main takeaway here is that if greenhouse gas concentrations stay the same, we'll certainly see temperatures rise, and we'll see more precipitation as well. So traffic flow, that's something that I'm personally very passionate about, living in the city and working at the lab. It's something that we can model at the laboratory using complex adaptive systems. So what you're seeing here is an animation, but it's extremely advanced mathematics and algorithms behind this animation. And what we do here is actually model each individual car or bus or train, whatever the case is, as an individual agent. And then we allow those agents to interact and are able to see how different scenarios could potentially play out, both with interventions, technologies, or even, for instance, looking at how we could evacuate the city more effectively. Same thing for disease spread modeling. It's another similar model that we use. We use complex adaptive systems to study how diseases can travel through a city. As we've looked throughout history, we know that diseases in some cities flourish because of human contact, others die. This is actually a simulation of a MRSA model going through the city of Chicago and looking at how different agents interact given their contact and how a disease could spread throughout the city. So that leads me to the future, and how do I see us going forward? Well, the future is truly in both basic and applied science to truly advance our understanding of how cities work, and we need to do that with the user facilities that we have at the lab, and of course, most importantly, the exceptional minds and people that we have at the lab, and then because this is truly an interdisciplinary problem, we need exceptional partners with people that are here in the audience today. So from the lab to the city, we see this as the key to our success. Here are just a few key partners that we're working with on this issue. There are many more, but this is just a few to illustrate the example. So let me close by saying that innovation is driven by collaboration, and collaboration requires smart, diverse, and creative people. That is what is in cities, and it's precisely what is needed to truly understand cities. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to take questions and ideas.
Questions for Leah? You talked about three criteria, the climate disruption, economic vitality, and so on. Is it possible to score cities on how they're doing vis-a-vis those things? And what's the best city?
Chicago?
Yeah.
Thanks, Matt. That was a good one. So clearly there's a lot of that going on, and cities are trying to do that. You see all sorts of different index measurements that are going on. I don't know that there's really a best way to do that, and I think that actually speaks to the true nature of cities. If you measure for one thing, you're almost inherently not measuring for another. So to say that there's kind of one best city out there, I don't really think that that's the right approach. We need different cities to do different things.
Tim.
I just wanted to build on that a little bit. So you showed some examples of Chicago City. Are there key features of Chicago as a city that distinguish it from other cities in these modeling? You know, Chicago City traffic got a different mathematical approach than, say, New York traffic? Or are there fundamental differences in the framework that start to distinguish cities? Or if you develop a model, you can apply it to many cities?
Sure. Well, I think for the transportation piece, what you start to see there is more of, we're on a grid, obviously. So how people actually respond to that grid is probably a little bit different than how you would maybe see traffic or complexity chaos in a city like Boston, for example. So you do see differences. But in general, you know, every city will have some unique features. I do think a key part to this research initiative is to understand what is universal and what are kind of key ideas that are true to cities kind of across the globe. I mentioned the, you know, the 15% increase. That typically in research, that tends to kind of be pretty universal across most cities. So we're trying to look for those things, trying to discover those things. With that said, of course, every city will say they're different.
Nigel has a question here.
You mentioned that China was clearly one of your slides of people moving into the city. Do you view them as being very proactive and progressive about how to create cities and how to deal with the issues in cities compared to, say, the West?
It's a great question. I think that's unclear right now. This is a relatively new and fast-moving issue that we've seen. So I think kind of how that plays out and what we'll see is still to be determined.
Last question. That's it. We have time for one more, so go ahead, Eric.
So as you build up these models and answer some of the challenges in traffic or in carbon, et cetera, what kinds of partnerships, these are great to have the models and to point out to the cities, here's what you're doing right, here's what you're doing wrong. What kinds of partnerships do you need to develop to ensure that these are adopted as policy or adopted as programs in the cities, and how are you thinking about that?
So we're thinking about ways, and what we're doing is actually formally partnering with cities. So I mentioned the examples in Chicago. We spend a lot of time talking with people in Chicago. We're doing similar work in Detroit, which I think is very exciting because we actually have a lot of latitude there to try new things. Suffice to say that actually to be and work in cities is a critical part of this. And models are great, but the best models essentially tell you how wrong they are. And that's very important when informing policymakers.
Good. Thank you very much. Next, we're going to be hearing from Julie Huber. Julie's an associate scientist at the Marine Biological Laboratory in Woods Hole and also associate director of the laboratory's Josephine Bay Paul Center. An oceanographer by training, Julie's interested in how basic earth processes like rock forming, fluids moving, sediments accumulating, interact to create and maintain life in the oceans. She also studies the impact of microbial life on both human and planetary health. Her research takes her to a variety of deep sea environments around the world, including the world's deepest known hyperthermal vents and actively disrupting volcanoes. Julie, please come to the podium.
Well, it's a great pleasure to be here today. I spent much of my childhood in the suburbs of Chicago, so it's fun to be here today and tell you guys what's going on at Woods Hole, and in particular what this cartoon depicts, which is a lot of what happens in my own laboratory, which is looking for life in some pretty strange places, and in the examples I'm going to give you today in the deep ocean. So the MBL is dedicated to scientific discovery and improving the human condition through research and education in biology, biomedicine, environmental science. Myself and many others are interested in some of the really big questions that cross many biological disciplines. So how does life spread across our planet? How does life diversify? How do life and its co-environment evolve? And what does the future of life look like? These are really, really big questions. But in fact, I'm going to be talking today about the tiniest life forms on our planet. And even though this is a beautiful blue planet, we call it Earth, I want to convince you in the next 9 minutes that it's planet microbe. So what do I mean by that? So in sheer numbers alone, there's just a ton of microbial biomass on our planet. There's about 100 million microbes in a single gram of soil. There's more biomass or more carbon contained in microbes than animals and plants combined. In and on you, there's about 10 times more microbial cells than human cells, and there's more microbial cells on Earth than stars in the universe. These microbes come in a huge diversity of form and shapes and sizes, most of which are invisible to the naked eye, but they serve a myriad of important functions on our planet, from mediating critical biogeochemical cycles like carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. They provide us with delicious food, important drugs. They inhabit almost all animal species, invertebrates and vertebrates. And of course, sometimes we mess things up and they help us clean that up. So this remarkable amount of diversity in form and function, it's probably not surprising to know that microbes themselves, in fact, are just very diverse. So this is the universal tree of life, showing the three domains of life, the archaea, the bacteria, and the eukaryotes. These two domains are completely microbial, and much of this eukaryotic tree is, in fact, microbial. And this stunning diversification is due to the fact that microbes have been around for a very long time. Life originated on our planet about 3.8 billion years ago. So this huge span of diversity has to do with the fact that they've had a lot of time to evolve. And this is in contrast to humans, which sit over here in the animal node. Modern humans have been around for a few hundred thousand years, first appearing about 5 or 10 million years ago. So microbes have had a huge amount of time to evolve, and they occupy almost every habitat and niche on our planet. And even though I'm talking about microbes in the deep ocean today, it's important to know that recently the MBL, University of Chicago, and Argonne National Lab have joined together to form an interdisciplinary initiative that's really focused on understanding the microbiome. And the idea is to bring together these diverse groups of scientists studying everything from life at the bottom of the ocean to the human microbiome. We're asking pretty similar fundamental questions and to advance the science forward. But what we do very well in Woods Hole is we study the oceans. You all know that the oceans cover 70% of our planet's surface, and actually beneath the surface, there's some pretty remarkable things going on, which is what I want to talk about today. And a lot of this has to do with how our planet has formed and the process of plate tectonics. And it creates a number of remarkable features on the seafloor, and you can see them in this map. This, for example, is the world's longest mountain range, the Mid-Ocean Ridge. It's about 55,000 kilometers long, it's all underwater, and it's formed when two oceanic plates are moving apart and new crust is forming. What happens is then volcanism is created. In fact, most of the volcanism on our planet, about 80%, occurs beneath the water, which is why most people don't think about it. But this is a fundamental process that's critical to how our Earth has formed, the gases in our atmosphere, and the habitability of our planet. But to really appreciate how amazing what's happening in the deep ocean is, you have to understand what's happening in the surface ocean. And then this is a diagram of the marine food web, which actually is what's happening in all surface aquatic systems, including right here in Lake Michigan. So what happens through the process of photosynthesis that I'm assuming most of you are familiar with, single-cell bacteria or phytoplankton are harvesting energy from the sun and fixing carbon dioxide to produce carbon. That carbon then moves into this food chain and all the way up into grazers and the classic food chain that we're all part of. We're secondary consumers within this food web. This is how it works in the surface world. But how does it work in the deep ocean where you don't have sunlight and you have very little organic carbon? In these volcanic systems, we have to flip this food web over, and instead, the base of our food chain are these single-celled microbes, these bacteria and archaea. Instead of harvesting energy from the sun, they're harvesting chemical energy from these basic water-rock reactions that then feed into a very similar type of microbial food web and up into a food chain. We think we have a lot of the same players as we do in the surface world, but we actually, most of them are very poorly described or unknown. What we do know is that this ecosystem looks very different from the surface world. So this is perhaps the most well-known example. This is video footage from the Galapagos Spreading Ridge, which is where hydrothermal vents were first discovered in 1977. These giant tube worms, which can grow up to meters long, can survive in this dark, hot, harsh environment because they're stuffed full of microbes. Inside their gut are single-cell bacteria that are harvesting the chemical energy from these volcanic fluids, fixing carbon and creating organic matter that then supports the rest of this food chain. I like to remind my students that chemosynthetic life was not hypothesized. Nobody predicted it must exist on our planet. This was a completely accidental discovery by a bunch of geophysicists, in fact, and it completely turned biology on its end. And it's hard not to look at these types of videos and not think about what life might have looked like very early on in our planet's history. So some of the microbes that we study in my lab live completely disconnected from the surface world. And the discovery of organisms like these in other extreme habitats have led many scientists to talk about maybe life originated in these types of environments. So I have two examples up here. The first are the methanogens. These organisms are using volatile gases from these underwater volcanoes to create methane. In fact, methanogens have diversified an extreme amount. They're in your gut. They're in a lot of soils and other ecosystems. But in those cases, they're getting their hydrogen from fermenters, other organisms consuming carbon. In these volcanic systems, they're getting it from the water rock reactions. Similarly, we have groups of these sulfur-reducing bacteria in archaea, again, harnessing the power of hydrogen and combining that with sulfur in this case, which is also very rich in volcanic systems, to create energy. So these organisms live completely disconnected from the sunlit, organic carbon-rich, oxygenic world that we're really familiar with. The discovery of organisms like this on Earth and in other extreme environments on our planet has really opened up the search for life beyond Earth. These are three examples. These are high targets on NASA's list for searching for life outside our solar system, either past life or existing life. I think we're all pretty familiar with Mars, where recently there was an announcement that there's still surface water flowing on the surface seasonally. These are two moons. This is Jupiter. This is Jupiter's moon Europa and Saturn's moon Enceladus. They're both ice-covered bodies, but it's believed they have oceans beneath that icy shell. Whether or not we'll ever get to them and be able to figure out if there's life remains to be known, but that by studying extreme life here on Earth can really inform our decisions not only of what that life might look like, but also how we should look for it. So sometimes I feel like studying life in the deep ocean is a little bit like what I imagine going into space is like. So this is me in the submarine Alvin diving about 7,000 feet beneath the surface of the Pacific Ocean to collect samples for these deep ocean studies. We, just like NASA, have a mothership, and then we launch various tools depending on the question. For those of you who have seen the new Martian movie, Matt Damon taught us that maybe sometimes it's not a great idea to have a human presence. And in that case, we use advanced robotic tools where we're safely up on the mothership and we let the robots be put in danger. Once we have our samples back in the lab, we use all the powers of biological tools, earth sciences tools, physical and chemical sciences to really try to understand how these ecosystems work. So in my own laboratory, that includes using advanced DNA sequencing technology, stable isotope geochemistry, and the grand challenge of trying to bring these organisms back to life in our laboratories. So this might seem like really strange science, but in fact, the implications and applications are very wide-ranging, and that's what I want to close with today. So the discovery of these organisms with such novel metabolisms and different branches on the tree of life has really attracted a diverse array of scientists to the field. And here are a few examples of what some of those scientists are interested in. The first is genetically engineering their metabolism to make something else. And in this example, scientists have engineered some of these extremophiles to make either biofuels or industrial chemicals. The large diversity of organisms that we're discovering in the deep sea are a new target for natural product discovery, traditionally mostly done in soils or in coral reefs, for example, now looking for anti-cancer products, for example. And just last year, there was a new antibacterial gene, so a gene that's capable of killing bacteria, that was found residing in one of these extreme archaea isolated from a high-temperature black smoker chimney. And they're trying to patent it, and it's opening up new directions for how do we treat some of these superbugs that are such a problem. Now, some are taking life from the oceans. Others are interested in just taking stuff, material, from the bottom of the ocean. This is from an article early last year. The first formal agreement has been struck between a deep-sea mining company and a country, in this example, Papua New Guinea. So these hydrothermal deposits are really rich in things like copper and gold. And this is due to begin in the next few years, and the environmental impacts are almost virtually unknown. So as we begin to take away from the sea, I just wanted to close by reminding you that we have a lot left to learn. So this is video footage that was taken from an underwater volcano in 2009 near the island of Samoa. I was part of this expedition, and until our team found, filmed, and witnessed this eruption, no one had actually seen an underwater volcano erupt, which is pretty remarkable. This has been happening on our planet for 4 billion years. This is how oceanic crust is formed. This is how all of the gases in our atmosphere get recycled, right? Impacts our planet habitability. And what was truly remarkable, so you're seeing these exploding lava bombs in excess of 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. The plume above this volcano is full of sulfuric acid. The pH is around 1. But I can collect that sample, I can see microbes, I can detect their activity, I can sequence their genes. So life finds a way, even in these amazing habitats. So I would argue we have a lot more left of our planet microbe to explore. So thanks, I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Julie. Thanks a lot. Questions for Julie?
Yep.
Oh, Melody, and then there's a question there. Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Well, the life as we know here on Earth is based on the carbon cycle. But with NASA seeking life in space, there are some talks about life based on maybe on some other elements.
Sure.
So silicon, for example.
Looking for weird life, yeah. Right? Non-carbon-based life, silica,
so,
yeah.
So what's your opinion on that?
What's my opinion? Well, it's really hard to look for something that you've never seen before. We've learned through the powers of different techniques how to detect life, even though we don't really know what it is. I don't know if I have a stated formal opinion. I know that the scientific method usually can prove whether or not something is true. So there was a lot of controversy a couple years ago that someone had discovered arsenic life, that instead of having phosphate in the DNA backbone, it was arsenic. It was a very high profile paper that has since been through multiple experiments. It's not true. So my hope is that as we continue to develop these sensitive tools to detect different types of life, that we'll be able to A, find it, and B, you know, prove it really is life.
You brought up the reemergence of deep sea mining, and I believe you mentioned gold and silver. But back in the day, it was a whole different scene. It was like manganese nodules or something. I forget. You know, what's changed in that area?
No, manganese nodules are still a pretty big deal. The problem with manganese nodules is they're found in the middle of the ocean away from the continents. So just in terms of infrastructure, they're much harder to get to. And sort of the cost-benefit analysis doesn't make as much sense for these companies. The advantage of Papua New Guinea is those hydrothermal deposits, you can still see land while you're at them. And so in terms of all the infrastructure you have to maintain, all the people you have to shuttle back and forth, they've decided it's worth the cost.
What's the basic physical difference in these organisms that enables them to live under these circumstances? I know one thing, I have very limited knowledge of this, is that many of them have bilayer membranes that actually are unilamellar, two-headed things, so that their bilayers can't come apart.
So, you know, whether it's pressure or temperature or salt or pH, organisms have different way of coping. So temperature is one of the big ones in these systems. Basically, the cells have figured out ways to keep their DNA more tightly coiled so that it doesn't unravel under heat. They have more heat shock proteins, things to just kind of keep their cells more together. The amino acids they choose to put in their proteins are slightly different based on thermal stability. Similarly, with pressure, the membranes, how fluid they are, so they don't just, and same with cold temperature, so they don't just crack under all that pressure and temperature.
Time for one more if there is one. Otherwise, thank you, Julie. Okay. So our fourth and final speaker for this morning is Melody Swartz, the William B. Ogden Professor in the Institute for Molecular Engineering. Melody's research focuses on how lymphatic vessels and their transport functions contribute to adaptive immunity. She and her team are trying to target lymphatic vessels with the goal of improving cancer immunotherapy. Melody's received many honors, including the MacArthur Fellowship and the Venner Prize, which is Switzerland's largest prize for cancer research. Please welcome Melody to the stage.
This just fell, sorry. Hopefully it works. Well, thank you very much, and it's really exciting to be able to share a few words about my research with you. Just give me 1 second to plug this back in. Okay, so as Matt said, I'm an engineer who works in cancer immunology and immunotherapy. Now, what is that? That's okay. Now, what is that? To contrast it with traditional cancer therapy, traditional things like chemotherapy and radiation aim to kill certain features of cancer cells, like the fact that they're rapidly dividing or that they might mutate to express a particular protein. And so they kill cells that either rapidly mutate or express that protein. Of course, the problem is there's always some cells that don't behave as they should. Some cancer cells go into dormancy and they escape the chemotherapy. Some mutate further to downregulate that protein that's being targeted by the drug. And so most of these have a huge risk of relapse. What immunotherapy tries to do is activate the immune system to kill the tumor cells. And it has enormous promise, and people are extremely excited about it. It was named the breakthrough of the year last year by Science Magazine. And this is because if we can get it to work properly, it has a potential to actually cure cancer. And this is because it could train your immune system to recognize and kill cancer cells and then future cancer cells that come up. And so my research is particularly focused in the lymphatic system, which is like the information highway of your immune system. The lymphatics basically are sent, they're throughout your body, and there are about 900 lymph nodes in your body. And the lymphatic vessels carry information to the lymph nodes, which are the sentinels of the immune system. And this is where immune responses are mounted. So when you get a vaccine, T cells are, you have dendritic cells activated, T cells get activated in your draining lymph node, and then they go and attack any future infection. Now, the immune system can be explained in a very crude and simple analogy, but it actually might help to explain the rest of my talk. So immune surveillance is sort of like police surveillance, in that you have patrollers all the time, you have detectives all throughout your body, always locally investigating, just going around, seeing if anything is wrong. They not only find danger, but they also just see if somebody's hurt, if something needs help. They also try to identify if something is foreign, and if it is that safe or not safe? All right, so this could be something like as innocuous as a cat stuck in a tree, or something as dangerous as a terrorist with a bomb. Those surveillance people go transmit information to the police station. They give the police information about what the person looks like, what the person's wearing, where he is, what car he drives, all kinds of information, and importantly, how dangerous that person is. That informs the police officer here sitting at the desk to know how to coordinate a response. And they could either send out a SWAT team or a fireman to go rescue the cat, or anything in between, right? So your immune system is really pretty similar in a way, in that we have dendritic cells that act to constantly survey, to look at everything constantly going on in your tissues. They sometimes find dangerous things like pathogens, viruses, and bacteria. Sometimes they find cells that are just dying and need to be cleaned up. They can also see cancer cells because they notice if a cell is kind of mutating too rapidly when it's not supposed to be. They use the lymphatics to get to transmit that information to the immune system, which takes place locally in these lymph nodes. And in the lymph nodes, they activate T cells. And what's interesting, so the T cells are like the SWAT team, right? They're the ones that are going to go activate the response. They're the responders. But the dendritic cell needs to tell it all kinds of information. It needs to tell exactly what cell to kill, but also with different signals that it gives it, it tells it how to respond. Is it something that is safe or something that is very dangerous? Now, as I mentioned, cancer can get an immune, you normally get an immune response to cancer. And in fact, everybody who doesn't have cancer in this room has a very successful immune system that recognizes cancer cells that constantly are coming up and getting cleared by your immune system. When a cancer is successful in escaping that, that's when there's a problem. And cancer has very nice, I keep wanting to hit this. So it has multiple mechanisms to escape the immune response. This includes immune ignorance. It's in fact hiding. The immune system doesn't even know it's there. It includes suppression, which is making the immune system, it's suppressing the immune system. It's sending signals to make them less active. And there's also tolerance, which is actually like making the immune system into zombies. It's turning them around to ignore them, even though they know it's dangerous. Now, as I mentioned, the lymphatic system is really the information highway. And if you look at this picture of how the lymphatics are connecting the tumor to the lymph node, what my research has focused on is how this is contributing to the immune response. And what we found, this is unfortunately a very poorly studied area. Not that many people have really studied the lymphatic system and really what it does to immunity, even though it's so central. And so what my lab is doing, really half of it, is focused in understanding and discovering what roles the lymphatic system plays. And what we've discovered, for example, is that the lymphatic system is actually enablers of this immune escape. The lymphatics help the tumor escape immunity. They're important for bringing the information to the lymph node, but what they do is they give safe signals to the lymph node. So they bring all the information, but they also bring signals that say, take all this information and know that this is safe. This does this both by the stuff that it drains to the lymph node and by local things that the lymphatics do to help suppress and tolerize the T cells that do come to kill the tumor. And so we think that this is really something that tumors hijack, that's a normal process. In fact, this might be the reason that we have the lymphatics and the lymphatic expansion and infection as a way to prevent autoimmunity to your own antigens when you do get an infection. Tumors then hijack that. So a key point here is that the sentinel lymph node is containing all the information that's specific to the tumor. These are usually the things that the surgeon cuts out. So with that, just to summarize really quickly, really the main take-home message is that the lymphatics are supporting the tumor by taking all that information, but giving deceptively safe signals. The other half of my lab is focusing on how we can target that for therapy. A few examples I'm just going to show you are, one, we have the idea to take the tumor-draining lymph node, which is full of information, but it's being told that this is all safe and to ignore it. So what we're trying to do is target just danger signals to that lymph node and not have to do anything else except reprogram the immune system to ignore the tumor. And to do this in collaboration with Jeff Hubble's lab, we've been working with nanoparticles that can target lymph nodes that can deliver these danger signals. And this is just an example, which we were really excited about. This is in an experimental tumor model in a mouse. This is a very aggressive tumor in white here that grows very fast. If we vaccinate it at day 7 with these lymph node targeting nanoparticles, in a non-involved lymph node, we see that it takes a very long time for the immune response to respond, just like any vaccine, because it needs to generate new T cells. We see that at about 12 days, it starts to respond and kill the tumor. But if we instead vaccinate that information-rich tumor-draining lymph node, we can see that the cells are immediately responding. They're already there, they're already expanded, they just need to be told what to do. And so they go and they kill that tumor and the tumor never grows back. When it takes a long time to mount the immune response, the tumor can meanwhile mutate and respond and find other mechanisms to escape. So it successfully relapses. So that's just an example. We're also trying to target these lymphatic vessels to change the way they're communicating information from safe to danger. We're also trying methods to destroy local lymphatic vessels, and this is just an example with photodynamic therapy, and this is an area of our lab's research. These are lymphatic vessels that are getting killed. It was a movie, but it's not working. And the red cells here are lymphatic endothelial cells that are getting killed by this phototoxic drug. Finally, part of my lab is focused on tissue engineering model systems so that we could study human patient tumors in vitro. So the idea would be to take a patient's tumor, biopsy, make 100 mini tumors in culture with an intact immune system, and this is the difficult part of this, perfused for several days so that we can screen various immunotherapies and try to understand what would be the best treatment for each particular patient. Now, this work is part of a bigger field of immunoengineering. And this, I talked about cancer immunotherapy, but this is a really new and evolving field within the bioengineering community. There are many researchers now working to develop new types of vaccines to prevent and treat infectious diseases, inverse vaccines to prevent and treat autoimmune diseases or allergies, so training the immune system to ignore something that it is attacking. And then an important part of translational immunology is that it's not very quantitative. It's very trial and error still. And so there's a big need for engineers to step in and develop analytical tools and quantitative and computational and numerical tools to understand and evaluate immune responses. And so finally, I just want to highlight that this is a really important area for us here at the IME and the University of Chicago. This is an area that we've chosen to focus on. And I have four wonderful colleagues who are doing other areas of immunoengineering, including Matt Terrell, who is working in nanomaterials, advanced nanomaterials, to prevent infectious diseases to, like drug-resistant bacteria, for example. Jun Huang, who is doing advanced optical methods for understanding how T cells get activated in a way to make cancer immunotherapy more effective. Savash Tay, who's going to join very soon, who works in microfluidic models of understanding how pathogens are recognized by the immune system in order to have a deeper understanding of new immunotherapies in the future. And then finally, Jeff Hubble, who does really nice and interesting protein engineering and materials engineering techniques to make inverse vaccines, that is, to treat autoimmunity. And so this field really hopes to contribute to translational immunology and really come up with completely new ways in the near future to treat a lot of these diseases that are now just managed and not really cured. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and answer any questions. Yes?
Question.
Really great stuff.
Thanks.
You mentioned photodynamic therapy. In real life, in a patient, for example, how would it be delivered? How would it be steered? There must be light involved, lasers. I have no idea.
Yeah, so we think that would be useful for melanoma, basically, which is near the surface of the skin. It's used to kill blood vessels, but it hasn't been used for lymphatics, except in a very experimental way. So it would be one way to manipulate the lymphatics and alter the immune response, but we're still trying to understand what that does to the immune response.
Optical fibers are one way to get things inside.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Everybody's ready for lunch, I guess.
No, I think this was very interesting, and you know, I have not only do I like this because my picture appeared, but it focuses us at the end here on some aspects of the Institute for Molecular Engineering, which is really trying to be positioned to cross these interfaces with Argonne, with MBL. I've been out to Fermilab too, so I hope we can do more of this. So I'm going to thank Melody and then invite Eric up for some last words.
So thanks, Melody, Julie, Leah, and Marcella for outstanding talks. Thanks, Matt, for moderating this discussion. I think as you can see, the University of Chicago, Fermilab, Argonne, and MBL have a really long history and a deep history of scientific breakthroughs that you've seen some of today. Our extraordinary researchers, you've heard from them today, have done some amazing things to really transform health, to transform technology, and continue to do great science. I mean, the examples I found fascinating. First one was just spectacular, discussing about the dark matter, something we thought we understood everything in the universe. Now we realize we only understand a small fraction of it. And can we create that matter in a laboratory? That's an amazingly deep question. Urbanization, thinking about the pressure on cities, the incredible growth around the globe. We heard that by 2050, we'll talk about 70% of all Chinese and around the world people living in cities, and thinking about how to set policies that will
that will make those healthy environments and innovative environments as they are today. That was just a really interesting discussion. And then this idea of the evolution of life, and can we learn about the diversity of the evolution of life by looking in pretty extreme environments, and then start thinking about predicting the evolution. I hope I'm getting this right. I mean, even thinking about, you know, is there life on Mars, and is something we learn here on carbon-based life something relevant to a broader sense of what life's all about? And then lastly, this really interesting idea of turning the body's immune system essentially against cancer, actually co-opting it in a way which could really help cure cancer. These are remarkable kinds of questions that our scientists and engineers are asking at these four institutions. And I hope you also saw how collaborative these endeavors are. These aren't individual scientists, although often the individual scientists have great ideas. Often these big projects going down to the bottom 7,000 feet under the ocean is not just one person. As much as you go down alone, you showed yourself alone, I'm sure behind that there's a lot of collaboration that goes on. So the idea that we as a group of four institutions and beyond can continue to do this kind of great work is only getting stronger and stronger. So with that, I'd like to thank all of you for coming. This concludes the session this morning. I hope you've learned as much as I have, and we look forward to seeing you again and again. Thank you.